Yo, YouTube, we're back, and I'm doing something I've never done before, but I was approached by my friend William, you guys have seen on my show before, he's spoken on Catholic topics, to moderate a debate. And so I thought that would be fun, and so that's what we're doing here today. And so I got my friend William, and I've got Dustin Nemos, both very intelligent men on the faith, but have very divergent ideas on some aspects of the faith. When I say the faith, I'm saying Christianity now, broad stroke. So today's debate is on whether or not the Catholic Church is the whore of Babylon in the book of Revelations, as well as is Mary the sinless mother of God. So it's sort of maybe two different things we're talking about, but one big ball of wax. So the way this goes is I'm going to allow William to open. He's going to state his case on Whore of Babylon and Mother Mary. And then you'll go about 25 minutes. We'll pass the mic to Dustin, hear his stance on it, and then the two will cross-examine. And I think this will be a lot of fun. So without further ado, William, great to hear from you again, buddy. Pleasure to have you on my show again.
Thank you for having me again, brother. Thrilled to be here with you. Thrilled to be here with Dustin as well.
Yeah, this is cool. So this is a great debate because as a, a revert to the faith myself, I've wrestled with these questions, particularly the stuff about Mary, but the Whore of Babylon stuff I've heard come up before. So what is your position on these two controversial topics? Is the Catholic Church the Whore of Babylon in Revelation? And what about Mary?
Yeah, you're right. Should I begin? Whenever you're ready, I'm going to be taking the, I'll be taking the affirmative that Holy Mary is the sinless Mother of God, and I'll be taking the negative in terms of the Catholic Church, and my friend Dustin will be taking the positive on the Whore of Babylon and the negative on the Mary. But I'll be beginning whenever you two are ready. I can begin my timer, brother Elliott. Can I begin now?
Awesome, you're on, buddy.
Let me start now. Great. Well, I'm thrilled to be here with everybody, thrilled to be here with Dustin and my brother, Elliott, the day after Thanksgiving. So all of our bellies are a little bit full today, but I think we're going to have a really good time talking with each other. And I'm thrilled, really, to be able to defend Mary as the sinless mother of God and to show how the claim of the Catholic Church being the whore of Babylon is outlandish. There's a lot to unpack, so I'm going to begin now. And I'll begin the discussion on St. Mary as the mother of God, biblically. We can go through history as well. It's a knockout case. In fact, it's quite the hill to climb for my friend Dustin today. He's in a bit of a bind. Mary as mother of God holds deep theological significance within Christian tradition and is firmly rooted in both the Bible and unanimity in early church history. Throughout the presentation, I will draw from biblical passages, the writings of the early fathers, and the insights of respected scholars to support and illuminate the venerable title accorded to Mary. Indeed, the title comes directly from the Bible. Biblical foundations for Mary as Mother of God. In the Gospel of St. Luke, chapter 1, verse 43, we have a very compelling case for the scriptural basis for Mary as Theotokos, as Mother of God. In Luke 1:43, Elizabeth, filled with the Holy Ghost, exclaims to Mary, "And how is this granted to me that the mother of my Lord, Kyrios, should come to me," or Kyrios, depending whether you want to utilize modern day Greek or the ancient Koine pronunciation. Elizabeth's words affirm not only Mary's role as a mother, but also as the mother of her Lord. Very clear reference to Christ as Almighty God. Galatians 4:4, we read the incredible Greek phenomenon ekunikos. We read of the fullness of time. Paul in Galatians 4 declares, "But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law," emphasizing not only the divine nature of Christ, but also underscoring the crucial role of Holy Mary as the woman through whom God chose to bring forth his son. In terms of early fathers that support this, we've got this from the apostolic era and beyond, the great Saint Ignatius of Antioch, a disciple of the apostles, indeed taught and trained by the apostle Saint John, wrote in his letter to the Ephesians, "Hidden from the prince of this world was the virginity of Mary and her childbearing, and likewise also the death of the Lord. Ignatius emphasizing Mary's role in childbearing and linking it to the Lord, indicating a recognition of her as the mother of our Lord, the mother of our incarnate God. St. Irenaeus of Lyon, the great bishop of Lyon, who had a very clear connection as well to the apostles, having been taught by the bishop Polycarp, who was taught and trained by the apostle John, says in his work, Contra Heresies, Mary's role in the incarnation, he notes, the knot of Eve's disobedience was loosed by the obedience of Mary. For what the Virgin Eve had bound fast through unbelief, this did the Virgin Mary set free through faith. This early church father draws a parallel between Eve and Mary, positioning Mary as integral to the divine plan of redemption. St. Athanasius, a key figure in the defense of Nicene Orthodoxy, wrote in his Discourses Against the Arians, therefore, let those who deny that the Son is from the Father by nature and proper to his essence, deny also that he took true human flesh from the ever-Virgin Mary, i.e. Parthenos, Maria. Athanasius connects Mary's perpetual virginity with the divine nature of Christ, reinforcing her role as the Mother of God, and over refers to her as Theotokos, over and over. Remember the titles of the debate today. Today, the burden of proof is on me to prove what is laid out about Mary. I've got to prove it. I have to. And the burden of proof is on Dustin when we talk about the Whore of Babylon being the Catholic Church. But very clearly, look at everything laid out thus far. The theological significance of Mary as Mother of God. The incarnation and Christology is at the heart of calling Mary the Mother of God. Understanding Christology and understanding the hypostatic union, which is why I say my friend Dustin has quite the hill to climb today, because Christology is at the heart of Mary as Mother of God. Her title, Mother of God, which even before Ephesus in 431, is utilized all over the place. Simply a simple search in the TLG, which is the heart, the beating heart of scholarly research. The TLG, which is the Thesaurus Lingua Graecae, shows that multiple fathers, well before you ever even get to the doorsteps of Ephesus, utilize this title. My friend Dustin here, unknowingly, unwittingly, says over and over in his webpages, this comes about in 431. Very clearly, Dustin has no idea how to utilize the theological databases, as this title was utilized over and over, over 300 years before 431, and also taken directly from the Greek construction in the Gospels of the Bible. Mary's title of Mother of God is profoundly important. The theological implications for understanding the incarnation are important, as all of the Cappadocians pointed out in their great battles against the Arians. Recognizing her as merely the mother of Jesus, as the Nestorians would do later on in history, and they would get roundabout condemned, is a denial that Christ is fully God and fully human. And it underscores the inseparable union of the divine and human natures of Christ. Now we get to the doorsteps of Ephesus in 431, which affirmed Mary as Theotokos. And you can anglicize it if you want, as Theotokos, doesn't matter how you pronounce it, either which way. What does it mean? It means God-bearer, in essence, Mother of God, as Pope St. Leo the Great pointed out, and as all the scholastics pointed out, literally meaning one that bore God. The designation was central to the Council's defense of Orthodox Christology against the Nestorian heresy, which sought to separate Christ's divine and human natures. For a little bit of Christological history, even before Ephesus, we had those denying the incarnation. It was a major problem. Yet not even Arius denied Mary as the mother of God, because even Arius believed Christ was God, although he believed Christ was God, a created deity who was elevated to the nature of God, not pre-existent God. So knowledge in church history is very important. Thus, you realize when you dive into early church history, you realize what was done at Ephesus was not merely a novelty, as the act of Ephesus show us over and over, that multiple councils before it and early fathers hearken to the scriptures and hearken to evidence from the biblical era and from the patristic era to support Mary being called Mother of God. Indeed, when we see Elizabeth quoting in the Gospel of St. Luke, chapter 1, directly quoting from 2 Samuel, the Greek looking and noting that how is it that the mother of her Lord should come to her? It's a direct quotation from 2 Samuel. Well, who is the Lord in 2 Samuel? Well, it's very clearly Yahweh. Very, very clearly. There's no way around that. Whether you look in the Hebrew or whether you look in the Greek, it's Yahweh. It tells you, gives you the identity of Mary very early on. We have that elsewhere as well. But of course, it suffices to show that the biblical proof of Mary as Mother of God, and the early patristic proof is very clearly there as well. Biblical scholar Dr. Michael Barber notes in his work on Mary in the New Testament, he notes that it is, quote, important to emphasize and underscore Luke 1:43 to recognize Mary as the mother of the Lord. And then he will later on contend that the title implies Jesus' divine nature and reflects an early Christian understanding of Mary's unique role. So the title Mother of God, given to Mary, is firmly grounded in both the Bible and early church history. Now, remember the title of the debate, multiple titles, Mary, the sinless mother of God. I've got to prove that Mary's also sinless. We're going to talk about that as well, because obviously if I'm going to talk about her as being the mother of God, I better be able to prove she's sinless as well. Otherwise, Dustin's going to come for me and say, hey, you forgot about that, the sinless one. And I've got to tell the audience, Dustin's in a lot of trouble today. When we get into the cross-examination on Mary being sinless, he's in trouble, because the Bible is very clear on that as well. But let me finish, let me wrap up with Mary as Mother of God, and note that this is very clear in the Bible, in the writings of the early fathers, which affirm her as the Mother of Christ, the Mother of Christ, who is Christ, Almighty God, who is both fully divine and fully human. The theological significance of Mary as the Mother of God was formally recognized at Ephesus, even at Chalcedon, at every council where Christology was at the beating heart of the issues. And contemporary scholars continue to affirm the traditional understanding of the venerable title. And who would have thought, even modern day historians no longer contest Mary as Mother of God with their joint Christological declaration that was signed many years back with Rome. They no longer deny that Mary is Mother of God, because before the death of Nestorius, he returned to the fold of the church and was no longer denying that. So Mary's role in the divine plan of salvation remains a cornerstone of Christian theology, connecting the faithful to the mystery of the incarnation and the profound union of the divine, of the human and the divine in Jesus Christ. Now, when we talk about Mary as being without sin, it's very important to look at how the Bible presents Mary to us. Mary is presented as the new ark of the new covenant all over the New Testament. The theological perspective is deeply rooted in both the Bible and the early church fathers, drawing connections between Mary and the new ark of the and the ark of the covenant, the old ark described in the Old Testament. I will look at biblical passages and the writings of the fathers to show that in the New Testament, Mary is presented as the new ark, as being all holy and all sinless. In Luke 1:26 to 38, Luke provides a crucial biblical foundation for understanding Mary as a new ark. In the Annunciation, the angel Gabriel declares to Mary, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, pischiazo, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. That is the overshadowing, Luke 1:35. The overshadowing recalls the language utilized in the Old Testament to describe the presence of God over the Ark of the Covenant. In Luke 1:39 to 56, Mary's visit to her cousin Elizabeth further reinforces a parallel between Mary and the ark. When Mary greets Elizabeth, the baby in Elizabeth's womb, John the Baptist, leaps for joy. And Elizabeth exclaims, "And why is this granted to me that the mother of my Lord should come to me?" The utilization of the exclaiming there, the particular very rare Greek word, only appears in the presence of the ark. All over the Old Testament and the New Testament, the only time that very rare Greek word appears, and you can do a search in the TLG, the Thesaurus in Greek Rece, it only appears whenever one is in the presence of the ark, directly pointing to Mary as that incredibly important figure. This echoes the reverence shown to the ark in the Old Testament, presenting to us that Mary is indeed that all-holy, all-stainless ark of the new covenant. In the book of Revelation, John sees a vision of the heavenly temple. Towards the end of verse 11, the ark of the covenant is mentioned, opened in the temple. Immediately following that, John describes a woman clothed with a sun, with a moon under her feet, and a crown of 12 stars on her head. The woman is very often, the earliest interpretations of Revelation 12 are a Mariological one, as Mary bodily present in heaven. Indeed, the church has believed from the beginning that Mary was bodily assumed. You got it right there in Revelation 12. The earliest interpretation of Revelation 11 is Mary, then you are, interpreted by Pascasius Robertus. Revelation 12, second century interpretations view Mary as a woman of Revelation 12. And how can you not view Mary as that woman crowned in glory if you read that that woman of Revelation 12 is the mother of the Messiah? Good luck getting around that. The connection to the ark is unmistakable. For early fathers that lay this out, you've got St. Gregory the Wonder Worker, St. Ambrose of Milan, St. Irenaeus of Lyon, the Proto-Evangelium of James, and on and on and on. Why is it significant to refer to Mary as a new ark? The concept of Mary as a new ark underscores the profound reality of God's presence dwelling within her. This parallels the Ark of the Covenant, which housed the tablets of the Ten Commandments, symbolizing God's covenant with his people. Mary as a new ark carries within her the incarnate word, embodying the new covenant between God and humanity. The holiness of Mary. Just as the Ark of the Covenant was considered holy and set apart, Mary is understood as uniquely holy by virtue of being chosen to bear the Son of God. How does the angel greet Mary? Hail, Kyrie Kecharitomene. What does that mean? Hail, having been fully graced. And later in the show, we're going to go into the tense of the Greek. She doesn't get blessed at that moment. She doesn't get filled with grace at that moment. She was filled at a time in the past. Even before the angel appears to her in Luke chapter 1, Mary is filled with that particular kind of grace. We can look at Protestant Bible scholars that are experts in Greek that will note that. The top scholars in the world in Greek will note that. And the early Greek fathers are unanimous on Mary. And by the way, the angel doesn't greet her and tell her, hey, you're full of grace. The angel greets her in the vocative, as in a titular fashion. Hail, having been fully graced. Hail, full of grace, in a titular fashion. Not, hey, Mary, how you doing? You're filled with grace. No, hail, an honorific kind of greeting. Hail, you who are full of grace. Very important. And this is noted by multiple Greek scholars. So, and the other thing that we point out before, and I'm glad I have enough time to get into the, now to hop into the top, talking about the Whore of Babylon talk, is in Luke 1:28, where we talk about Mary is full of grace, and Ephesians 1:6, Luke 1:28 has full of grace. The angel Gabriel's greeting to Mary in Luke 1:28 contains a phrase of particular significance. We talked about it earlier, the Greek kecharitomene, often translated as full of grace. The term is a perfect passive participle, which shows us that Mary was in a state of being that was initiated in the past, but continues in the present. The Greek root word for full of grace, by the way, we have all of this laid out in our book that we wrote on Mary. The Greek root word for full of grace is charis, which means grace or favor, depending how it's used. The term is crucial for understanding the theological depth of Mary's state as being full of grace. The direct parallel to this is found in Ephesians 1, where the root word charitao is found in Ephesians 1. The verb form of the root word charis is used. Or charis, however you want to say. The verse very clearly shows this right there as we read a keratosin, the root word being keratao, which is translated to the praise of his glorious grace with which he has blessed us in the beloved. The root word here is connected to charis and shares the only other area in the Bible, in the New Testament, and the Jewish Old Testament, which shares a linguistic connection, is with Luke 1, a direct linguistic connection with a term. What term? The term used to describe Mary in Luke 1:28. This linguistic connection underscores the depth of God's grace in both contexts. Very clearly, I know today's debate is not about the Immaculate Conception, it's about the sinlessness of Mary, but connected directly to that is what the church has taught from the very beginning, that Mary was holy and completely immaculate. The understanding of Mary as full of grace aligns with the Catholic dogma of the Immaculate Conception, which shows that Mary was preserved without any stain of original sin from the moment of her creation. You can use the language of conception or creation, depending on what scholastic you want to point to. We get that language directly from the papal bull, Ineffabilis Deus, from 1854. The idea is that God's grace was so abundant in Mary's life that she was kept free from the stain of sin. The association of being full of grace with Mary has profound implications for her sinlessness. If grace is understood as the divine favor that indeed does protect from sin, then Mary's state of being full of grace suggests and directly lays out her freedom from that particular kind of sin. For the sinlessness of Mary, you've got the great proto-evangelium of James, which is utilized in the early church, St. Clement of Alexandria, which was a late second century early church father, was a leader of the catechetical school of Alexandria, founded by St. Mark. You got St. Augustine, St. Ambrose, Ephraim the Syrian. And I could go on and on just with that list alone. But we've got about 6 minutes and six and a half, and I've got to talk about the Whore of Babylon. Now, I reserved only 6.5 minutes for that because I don't have to prove the Whore of Babylon is anything. Anything. The whole onus of that is on Dustin. To prove that biblically, that's the Catholic Church. And I don't envy that burden on him at all. The identification of the Whore of Babylon in Revelation was debated all throughout church history. You very clearly have people early on saying it's one particular group. Hey, we believe it's the Nestorians. Hey, later on in history, they attributed to Islam. Not official. These are not official catechisms or teachings, but various writers and commentaries. But one interpretation which arose, and well, it arose during the time of the Reformation and later, was one that you never find in early church history, was identifying the whore as the Catholic Church. You don't find it in ancient history. You don't find it even in the enemies of the faith. You figure you'd find something in early history, just one thing before you get to Luther. You don't find anything, not until you get to the anti-Semite Luther. You don't find anything in terms of the Whore of Babylon being the Catholic Church. And by the way, he walked that back as well before he died. In his German writings, in his disavowal in Purgatorio, which by the way, he believed in purgatory in the beginning, before his death, walked that back. Luther flip-flopped in just about everything, including the deuterocanonical books, which by the way, he never removed from the Bible, which is very telling. Never ever did. Those seven books that are lacking today in Protestant Bibles, in the majority of them, Luther never removed them. Now we hear that argument utilized by Catholics all the time. He never removed them. Whose fault do we blame? We blame it later on in very liberal scholarship that did remove those books. But can we put a little bit of the blame on Luther at his feet? Sure, he denigrated the status of them, but he never removed them. He was terrified of removing them. He would shake and think that God is going to strike me down if I remove from his word. He never did. But the evidence within the Bible repeatedly refers to Jerusalem as a metaphorical whore. Over and over throughout the Bible, the Old Testament references to Jerusalem as a whore. The prophet Ezekiel in chapter 23 vividly portrays Jerusalem and Samaria as two sisters who played the harlot. This metaphorical language underscores the spiritual unfaithfulness of Jerusalem. The book of Isaiah, particularly in chapters 1 and 57, uses strong language accusing Jerusalem of whoredom, portraying it as a city that has turned away from its covenant with God. There's no evidence that this is actually the early Christian church, or as Dustin would suggest, the church that Constantine would find. There's no evidence there either. So remember, there's going to be a very clear line in the sand drawn today. And my friend Dustin's about to get a chance to talk, but I want you all to pay attention to clear things. There's one person today who is going to utilize the biblical languages, scholars, and church history and sources. Now, I've gone to Dustin's website. You get zero. A big fat donut, zero. You don't get any of them. You get his opinion. You don't get anything scholarly. You don't get any exegesis. And today, if you want to hear a scholarly debate, you hold people's feet to the fire. You better say, okay, well, who is actually mentioning things and providing evidence? And you're going to find at the end of this debate, there's only one that will have done it today, unless by some miracle, a miracle that fell from the sky, Dustin all of a sudden changed his whole methodology. And the way his website and his theology and his debates are laid out has changed overnight. It will be a Christmas Day miracle. But I can promise you today, it will not. You will not get firsthand source material. You will not get biblical exegesis. And you will not get church history. I know that because of what we read of Ephesus 4:31. You don't get it. But you look in the Gospel of Matthew 23. I've got 2.5 minutes. How does time go by? Man, Dustin, when you get your time to speak, it's going to fly. It's going to fly, brother. Matthew 23, 37 to 39. Here you read of Jesus mourning over Jerusalem, declaring, "Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and stone those who sent you, how often I have longed to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, and you were not willing." Revelation 11, the city spiritually called Sodom and Egypt, where the two witnesses are slain, is identified as the great city that symbolically is called Sodom and Egypt, where their Lord was crucified. This unmistakably refers to Jerusalem. The historical context in which Revelation was written is crucial. Jerusalem at the time was a city torn apart by internal strife and external pressure. The Jewish people were facing incredible challenges. Excuse me, the city was on the brink of destruction. The apostasy of Jerusalem, marked by the rejection and crucifixion of Christ, as well as the persecution of his followers, aligns with the imagery of a wayward woman in biblical metaphor. Now, I provided that to you, the audience, even though the onus is not on me to say, well, I think it's Jerusalem. All I have to do is prove to you, or rather, all I have to do is rebut the claim that Constantine's created Catholic Church is that whore of Babylon from the Bible. That's all that needs to be done. It can be done very easily. You don't even need to use the Bible. All you have to do is look through church history. Thus, as I'm down to my final minute, the time has flown by. We've laid out a case for Mary as the mother of God, the holy Theotokos, holy God-bearer. We've laid out a case for Mary as the sinless holy mother of God, and we've clearly shown that the language of the Bible does not in any way indicate that the book of Revelation lays out the whore of Babylon as the Catholic Church. There's nothing there. Remember and put in your mind the thesis of today's debate and hold both of us accountable, because at the end of the debate, you're going to have to weigh and say, okay, well, I believe the case was better presented by either William or by Dustin, but you need to look at the thesis of today's debate. Now, I've got about 18 seconds, and I got to say, I'm excited to hear what Dustin has to say, and I'm even more excited to be able to engage with him. And he got me off track there by looking at my time. So I got 7 seconds left, and I want to hear what the brother Dustin has to say.
Okay. Thank you. Man, I've got a couple things to respond to, but I'll get to that later in the section. First, I just want to say Proverbs 27:17, iron sharpeneth iron. So a man sharpeneth the countenance of his friend. That's why we're here today. And then I'm going to jump into screen share. Can you guys see this okay? I'm going to talk right from the article that I have on thesarahpayum.com/Catholic. This article is titled Catholicism, the Scarlet Whore of Babylon. Beginning, Rome. I am not merely saying Catholicism gets it wrong, got it wrong sometime back then, or has gone astray. Nor am I really hoping to debate the nuance of Roman propaganda and history as a pseudo-Christian entity. I am directly cutting through the nonsense and saying that since before its inception, it was a lifelong pagan and false convert Roman emperor's way to stop Christianity by paganizing it and monopolizing it. It was a perversion by Satan. Its very claims to authority, being apostolic, are a lie. Peter never even went to Rome. It was all fabricated pretextual authority for Rome's bishops hundreds of years after Christ, a deception by the Scarlet Whore of Babylon, and it's the inventor and pioneer of modern fake news and fake science. It's a headquarters of evil on earth. There is no redeeming quality. Fatima is a demon. Yahweh's messengers are angels. That is what angel means, messenger. He does not send dead spirits from Sheol to communicate messages to us. And he forbids communicating with or praying to the dead. These false preachers teach people to pray to dead bones and angels alongside Muslims. Nothing about them is Christian beyond the naming scheme. Nothing. Their Jesus isn't even a man. It's baby Tammuz. Rome and its evil, necrotic, pagan mimicry of Christ's true faith, which it has never stopped persecuting, is the cause and culprit of the great falling away or apostasy. There is no defense for her. There is no defending her. She is anathema to biblical doctrine. She is evil. Her history is evil, full of systemic Christian mass murder and child rape. Her tenets and doctrine are wholly pagan, hated by Yahweh God. She truly sits upon seven hills with a golden cup filled with the filth of her fornications. This is how the Roman Catholic Church was formed. It's a mixture of occultism, paganism, and a hint of Christianity. God hates mixture. Just a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. When you think of how the Catholic Church came together, 300 AD, think amalgamation. Some foolishly, groundlessly believe that the Roman Catholic Church started off correctly, biblically. Not so. They have no clue of history or how this Antichrist cult was formed. In summary of the introduction, Rome's credibility is brokered than the Ten Commandments. They have no authority or legitimate claim to authority. Peter was not the first pope, nor was he the rock. He was a piece of the rock, Christ. It was never Christian, and they never stopped persecuting Christians. They have actually murdered over 50 million believers as martyrs, as heretics. And Rome's history of persecution violence has given the whole of Christianity a bad name. Such was its extent. I grew up as an atheist, hating Christians because of Rome's persecution of Christians, ironically, with what little I knew filtering through fake news and fake history. I was a lifelong anti-theist until I studied history and I studied globe Earth. Doctrines of devils also. Rome's doctrines are entirely anti-biblical heresies. It merely placed Christian names like Mary over demons like Isis. Rome worships Nimrod and Semiramis, the first couple of Satanism and the antithesis of Jesus Christ. I want to just go through some of the sections in my article here before we get into it. And we don't have a lot of time to go through all of it. The anti-Christian history includes persecution, such as the Crusades and the Inquisition. The deception, such as creating learning against learning under Cardinal Wolsey, which was papal approved. And that's where we get the government approved and pushing of fake science like evolution, heliocentrism, globe Earth, and ancient time. That's where you get things like vax science and global warming today, and old tranny science for the kids, everything. It's all coming out of what we call scientism. Doctrines of devils, pagan infiltration. It's all infiltration from Rome. It's nothing new except Roman propaganda. Mithraism was labeled as Catholicism, essentially. It's all Mithraic doctrine. Jerome was involved with a great word shift. The cross, the occult, and the Olympic Games are all connected. Constantine's pagan connection never stopped. He was a lifelong pagan. He actually outlawed Sabbath at certain times during his so-called Christian reign. And he continued to persecute Christians in other ways, monopolizing and essentially merging Christianity with the government and with paganism. That was the influence of Constantine, a lifelong pagan. The Mass is Mithraic. The lawless grace, Catholics do not teach to follow the law that Jesus died for so that we would remember, and he taught and he kept. They keep idolatry, such things as Mariolatry, which we'll get into on the rebuttal section, but also the deified apostles who did not want to be deified. This is forced apotheosis. It's like the rape of their identities. They have repetitive prayers, which God hates. They have things like Easter and Christmas, which have nothing to do with Christ. They have Sunday rather than Sabbath. Rome's stolen valor includes, as I said earlier, a false claim to Peter and apostolic authority. They have no claim to represent God or the Bible. They are a cult of charismatic experience directly behind today's one world religion efforts. And they can't read good, apparently, no offense, because there are numerous instances in the Bible where they are directly contradicting God's word with their doctrines, such as graven images, transubstantiation, dispensationalism, etc. So I also want to mention that they are behind most of the corrupted Bibles of today, such as the Latin Vulgate and the Douay Rheims, which is sort of like Catholicism's KJV. Correct me if I'm wrong. And then mentions in prophecy specifically, they are 100% all of them checked all the boxes. Everything specific included the colors, the sitting on the seven hills, the false prophet beast that creates the one world religion, the procession of empires. It all counts for Rome. They're in Revelation 17 and 18. And they're also in some of the hidden books that were taken out of all the modern Bibles, including the KJV, such as 2nd Esdras, the final world power in the seven ecclesias of Revelation, a book by a known prophet that was deleted from the Bible because it had, I guess, too many prophecies. But it was also a book that had a prophecy far more complicated and detailed than even Daniel's prophecy of the procession of empires, which is one of the most obviously complicated and precise prophecies of all time. And it's still disputed. They try to say, well, that didn't happen. They wrote it afterwards. It's the only way to explain how he knew all of those things. This one's twice as complicated. So test it. You'll see. And then, of course, we also have the current culture of pedophilia and systemic corruption, which I don't think we're going to have time to get into it, nor do I really believe that we'll need to, as they have developed a reputation for child rape, pedophilia. And the Pope is, I think, currently hosting trannies at the Vatican, if I'm not mistaken. So continuing on, I just basically wanted to go through those sections. You can go through any of that later in my article. We will not, we won't get to most of it today. And then right on into the anti-Christian history. So persecution. In Acts 20, 29 to 31, it tells us, "For I know this, that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock. Also of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things to draw away disciples after them. Therefore watch and remember that by the space of 3 years I ceased not to warn everyone, night and day, with tears." Paul warned us about Rome, who have murdered around 50 million believers, as I said earlier. They murdered Christians for reading the Bible until Tyndale's friends finally managed to use his notes and finish his work and the printing press to get the word out, so to speak. And then he was martyred by the church killing him. By using this newly created printing press to give the English-speaking world the first and only somewhat honest effort, really, there were other attempts, but they're all flawed, even the Tyndale version, at a reliable English Bible. For a more in-depth look at true Christianity, the Pilgrim Church that was persecuted and martyred for reading the scriptures, I suggest the documentary A Lamp in the Dark, The Untold History of the Bible. There's some other sources also in this article at the bottom. The Inquisition, just to remind people how violent they were, it began with the Albigenses in Albi, France. The Albigenses often debated with the Catholic priests, most notably with their so-called Saint Dominic, the Butcher of Albi, who accused the Albigenses of heresy. In his testimony, he confessed, "It is not by the display of power and pomp or by gorgeous apparel that the heretics win proselytes. It is by zealous preaching, by apostolic humility, and by austerity, by seeming, it is true, but by seeming, holiness." And the Albigenses had also not only continually beat him in debate, but also published this, quote, "The Church of Rome was not the spouse of Christ, but the Church of Confusion, drunk with the blood of the martyrs, that the Church of Rome was neither good nor holy nor established by Jesus Christ." Upon a final debate at the Colloque of Montreal in 1207 AD, where the final debate took place, historians relate as what was clearly seen as a defeat for Dominic. Quote, "Guzman was humiliated by his failure. Speaking on behalf of Christ, Guzman promised slavery and death to his opponents. To carry out his threat, Dominic would eventually form the Order of the Dominicans, or Dominicans, which became the chief enforcer of Rome's Inquisition. 3 years later, Pope Innocent III ordered the famous crusade against the Albigenses. Led by a close friend of Dominique's, the nefarious Simon de Montfort remembered the Catholics as a brave crusader, yet by Protestants as a brutal mass murderer, kind of like what's happening in Gaza today with these poor innocent people in France. The crusade of Simon de Montfort so utterly destroyed them that Simon stamped out not only a people, but a literature. By 1233 AD, Pope Gregory the Ninth would establish the Inquisition as official doctrine. And I never think I did that right or wrong. And thus began some 600 years of genocide against Bible believers. As a direct result of the Albigensian Crusade, popes began to outlaw the translation, possession, or reading of the Bible. One estimate put it at more than 50 million of the human family have been slaughtered for the crime of heresy by popish persecutors. More stories of the Pilgrim Church, such as the Waldenses, which existed outside of Catholicism, though history throughout history, unbeknownst to most today, which was constantly under persecution by Rome. Please see such books as The Pilgrim Church by E.H. Broadbent. Now, they also engage in doctrines of devils. I'm going to try to do what I can to get through some of that. Doctrines of devils, a pagan infiltration, a sampling. As Peter warned us in 2 Peter 2, 1 to 2, "But there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privily shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying Yahweh that brought them, that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. And many shall follow their pernicious ways, by reason of whom the way of truth shall be evil spoken of." Definitely many follow Catholicism of the various denominations of Christianity today. I doubt it's the remnant if it's so big. However, just going through some of the actual doctrines, let's touch on Mariolatry, for example. What we're here for today is partly Mary. I don't, by the way, I'm going to say this later, but I don't necessarily disagree with you that she was the mother of Jesus. The first 20 or so minutes of your speech, I mostly agreed with. I don't believe in some of the conclusions that you come to, such as the mother of heaven or queen of heaven from the mother of Jesus. However, sticking to the Bible, she's obviously the mother of Jesus. However, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away, according to Jesus. I can't actually just off the top of my head remember anything that Mary said, and I doubt many people can. However, everyone today remembers what Jesus said, even non-Christians. They seek to place men, dead saints, and Mother Mary, supposedly Semiramis actually, in place of Jesus Christ as the sole mediator and intermediary between man and God. Mary is Semiramis, Ishtar, Isis, the Mother of Heaven, as she was always called, and the Ever Virgin. Now, we know that through political maneuverings, Semiramis, the wife of Nimrod and unholy queen of the underworld, often referred to as the queen of or mother of heaven. We know that through the Bishop of Alexandria, Cyril, openly had inserted her into the Catholic faith. He anthropomorphized her into Mary. This is from Isis Unveiled. When Cyril, the Bishop of Alexandria, had openly embraced the cause of Isis, the Egyptian goddess, and had anthropomorphized her into Mary, the mother of God, and the Trinitarian controversy had taken place from that moment, the Egyptian doctrine of the emanation of the creative God out of Emet began to be tortured in a thousand ways until the councils had agreed upon the adoption of it as it now stands, the disfigured ternary of the Kabbalistic Solomon and Philo. I'm probably going to come back to the Mary stuff also for the 45 minutes, because I do want to touch on the Whore of Babylon stuff as well. But if you really get into all of this and you test what I say here, you'll find that the symbolism, all of it, the connections, it all goes back not to Jesus, but to Nimrod and his unholy wife and monstrous child. Was she ever virginal? I don't know how that's possible, because the Bible records that she had other children. For example, at least four brothers and two plus sisters. There was no record of her being ascended or assumptioned into heaven in scripture, which was actually filled with other examples of people being ascended, having assumption, like Enoch, Elijah. So it doesn't make any sense that they would have left it out in this one case. Also, the Queen of Heaven stuff, that has nothing to do with Mary. It never did. That was always a title for Semiramis, Isis, Ishtar, etc. Same woman, different names. The Tower of Babel explains that. God split the languages. So, moving into the mentions in prophecy, I just want to come back to this. Mentions in prophecy, section 3. And the kings of the earth who have committed fornication and lived deliciously with her, shall bewail her and lament for her when they shall see the smoke of her burning, standing afar off for the fear of her torment, saying, alas, alas, that great city, Babylon, that mighty city, for in 1 hour is thy judgment come. Mentions in prophecy specifically, such as the whore's colors, the Bible warns of the woman of Babylon, whose golden cup runneth over with fornication and filth, whose colors are purple, scarlet, red, and gold, an exact match for the Roman government. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color and decked with gold and precious and stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. Revelation 17:4. The procession of empires also clearly lines up with Daniel 2:41-43 and Rome, mentioned accurately by prophecy as the empire of iron and miry clay. Undeniably, though modern scholars pretend this text was written after the procession of empires was prophesied by Daniel, like I said, fulfillment of prophetic end times kingdom predictions, exactly. Whereas you saw the feet and toes, partly of potter's clay and partly of iron, the kingdom shall be divided. Yet the strength of the iron, that's Rome, shall be in it, just as you saw the iron mixed with ceramic clay. Moving on. You can see here, if you can see that, Rome 476 up to judgment, AD is the Rome and Gog merger, whereas before, BC 168 to 476 AD was just Rome. They lost their military empire, and then they merged under Satan's government, essentially, religiously using whatever authority that they had until the Reformation. Not that the Reformation was perfect. You won't find me defending it other than sola scriptura. The seven heads of the beast, and here is the mind which hath wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sitteth, Revelation 17:9. That's a very specific prophecy. Some people say it could also be Jerusalem, but we have to consider all of the prophecies. The false prophet beast, the Pope, and the beast was taken, and with him the false prophet that wrought miracles before him, with which he deceived them that had received the mark of the beast, that's the vaccine, and with them that worshipped his image. These both were cast alive into a lake of fire burning with brimstone, Revelation 19:20, Matthew 24:11, and many false prophets shall arise and shall deceive many. I believe this specific pope is that specific beast. However, all of the popes were antichrist, vicars of Christ or pretenders of Christ, really. So so-called substitutes, not that you can have a substitute for the only one that is a way to heaven. However, many people, including Martin Luther, Flacius, George Nigrinius, John Calvin, John Knox, etc., not that they're all perfect, agreed on this position that Rome was essentially the false beast and the Catholic whore of Babylon. Now, sins of the vicars. The papacy is nothing more than the ghost of the Roman Empire sitting crowned on the corpse thereof. I mean, here is a Catholic altar and here is a witch's altar. They're identical. Here is the using a satanic inverted cross behind them. There is the pine cone, which is a reference to Tammuz and Nimrod right outside of the Vatican. They put that kind of stuff right out there for people to see. The final world power, as I mentioned in 2nd Esdras, clearly matches them. We don't have time to go into it. Revelation 17, let's see if I still have 6 minutes. Revelation 17 talks about, and there came one of the seven angels. I'm sorry, I'll skip to five for time. Five, and upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. What is the mother of harlots? Cyprian of Carthage gave us a hint when he said he can no longer have God for his father who has not the church for his mother, because they want to monopolize your faith. They're the middleman, and you'll be killed and burnt with your Bible tied around your neck throughout much of their history if you disagree with them or their interpretation of the Bible. From this point on, the religion of Roman Catholicism took on the title Mother Church. This at 431 AD, Council of Ephesus, William was referring to Ephesus earlier, where they once cried for 2 hours, "Great is Diana of the Ephesians," according to Acts 19:34. They now exalted Mary as the Theotokos, the bearer of God. Converting to Catholicism is often referred to as coming home to Mother Church. It's all there for those who... 313 AD, Constantine gave the Lateran Palace on Caelian Hill to the Bishop of Rome. It became and still is the ecclesiastical...
I think we lost him, right?
Oh, man.
There, he's back. He's back.
I don't know what... What happened?
You had 5 minutes and 12 seconds, brother.
Okay, so just kind of jumping back into screen share there.
Yeah, please.
Vatican Mountain is not one of them, but they did get Caelian Hill at the Lateran Palace. The first basilica was built there by St. John Lateran, which within it is a throne called the Cathedra for the Pope. So they do have the seven hills. A city that reigns over the kings of the earth. Unum Sanctum 1302, Pope Boniface VIII invented the ex cathedra authoritative doctrine of the two swords, the spiritual sword and the temporal or terrestrial sword, human government. That's your iron and your clay right there. He declared in this church and in its power are two swords, namely the spiritual and the temporal. Both, therefore, are in the power of the church. And if the highest power of all err, it can be judged only by God and not by man. Essentially, he's declaring dominion over all governments in the world. Although the temporal governments have been turned over largely to the miry clay of latter times, the Empire of Iron lost its military enforcement authority, but not its influence and control over governments. Since 1929, most governments of the world have sent ambassadors to the Pope, and of course, Rome maintains a huge network of its own ambassadors and Jesuit spies, sworn to kill babies if necessary. So Revelation 18, we can also, the images are not showing right now, but gold, silver, ivory, precious things, Rome has an abundance of them, also linked to the scarlet whore. The pilgrim church has always been poor and humble. They haven't had money for expensive robes, except when God's people followed his law, King David, that sort of time. The queen of heaven, again, belongs to the Ishtar Semiramis, not Mary. In fact, we're warned about a queen for in Revelation 18, verses 7, how much she hath glorified herself and lived deliciously, so much torment and sorrow give her, for she saith in her heart, I sit a queen and am no widow and shall see no sorrow. The Queen of Heaven title belongs historically to Ishtar Semiramis, not Mary, who is the Queen of Heaven and has, no queen. There is no queen in heaven. Also, this goes back to the resurrection of Nimrod, prophecy of Semiramis, where she's going to bring back the Antichrist. That's where we get Christmas and Santa Claus and the Yule log ritual and all these weird satanic injections into Christianity from the Catholic Church, because that goes back to the story of Nimrod resurrecting at the end to rebuild his lost government, one world religion. That's this queen, and that's why she's not sorrowful, and she is not a widow, because he's coming back. That's the prophecy and the threat of the occult. That's what the Freemasons worship, Nimrod, etc. All of the secret societies basically worship him and try to bring him back. That's a whole different topic. I guess we could get into that as well. It is the seat of Satan and the synagogue of Satan mixed together. I know thy works, where thou dwellest, even where Satan's seat is, and thou holdest fast my name. Thou hast not denied my faith, even in those days wherein Antipas was my faithful martyr, who was slain among you, where Satan dwelleth. We know where that was at the time. So let me see if I'm hitting everything I wanted to hit. Basically, yeah, we're going through the list here. You can see, for example, some of the symbolisms that they use here, which go back to the not-so-star of David, the star of Remphan, because they are not the people of Israel. They are the demon Nephilim Edomites of end times, the enemy. However, it's all there in their symbolism. It's in their hats. You see the hat is actually a Dagon fish hat, just like the Dagon priest would wear, which looks like an open fish's mouth. That's a Dagon priest worship reminiscence. It's all there. All Catholicism is paganism rehashed. I'm probably down to 1 minute, 15 seconds. Okay. So just moving back, I guess, into bad doctrines, devils, pagan infiltration. Where did I leave off? I have a minute to go. A historical context from Rome's infiltrations in 300 AD, prayers to the dead, 300 AD, making the sign of the cross, 375 AD, veneration of angels and dead saints, 375 AD. And these could be off a year or two. There's some conflicting lists out there, but they're not debated. It just happened. Just when, right? The use of images in worship, the mass as a daily celebration, the exaltation of Mary with the term Mother of God applied at the Council of Ephesus in 431 AD. The last rites, the doctrine of purgatory, the prayers to Mary and dead saints, the worship of the cross images and relics, the canonization of dead saints, the celibacy of priesthood, the rosary, etc. It's all anti-biblical. They don't even know how to say, call no man father, because they call every priest father. It's all there. If you read the Bible for yourself, you cannot be a Catholic. I'm done.
Wow, very good. Thank you to Dustin and William. That was amazing to hear from both of you. We're going to move into the cross-examination section. And I believe, I open the mic to William, is that correct? Where you will now ask Dustin questions or vice versa? You're muted.
My bad. Thank you for that. Yeah, I'll be, and Dustin is muted too, so he can unmute since we're going to have a conversation. So I'll begin the timer right now. Thank you for that, Dustin. Dustin, in Luke 1:43, when St. Elizabeth is quoting from 2 Samuel in calling Mary the mother of her Lord, who is the Lord, the Kurios, in 2 Samuel?
Well, you get into the Trinity doctrine and basically Jesus and Yahweh being the same. And I have no argument against Jesus and Yahweh being the same. And I don't think that's necessarily the scope of this debate. However, Jesus was born of Mary. So I have no argument with 20 minutes of what you said almost. I believe that I have been misunderstood in that. I have no contest with Mary as being the mother of Jesus. I agree on this. I think it's completely obvious and scriptural. Any biblical, extra-biblical opinions as to her being sinless or the co-redemptrix of Christ are, however, nullified by the doctrine of sola scriptura, by scripture alone.
Yeah, well,
thus, I reject any Roman propaganda or exegesis.
Let me briefly interrupt there and say we're not talking about co-redemptrix. We're talking about Mary. Sticking to the title of the debate, is Mary the mother of God and is she sinless? So I noticed there you call her the mother of Jesus. So I'm going to go right back to that. So we're not getting into the topic of the Trinity. I don't know what your position is there or not. And we could talk about sola scriptura if you want any day. The simple question is, in 2 Samuel, where Elizabeth is quoting from, where she says, why is it granted me the mother of my Lord should come to me? Who is the Lord from 2 Samuel 6? Is that Yahweh?
Without the verse in front of me, it's probably Yahweh. It may say Jesus.
Right. So it is Yahweh. How can it say Jesus? It's the Old Testament. 2 Samuel, Dustin. It's not going to say Jesus. Of course it's right. Yahweh. So if it's Yahweh in 2 Samuel 6, and Elizabeth is quoting that in Luke 1:43, You have no issue with Mary being the mother of Yahweh then. Is that correct?
Well, Yahweh was born in a physical body. That's right. What Jesus was. So yeah, so I have no problem with that.
So you would agree you have no problem calling her the mother of God then?
Well, Jesus, or Yahweh, I guess, was born of a virgin woman, not a sinless virgin woman.
Right. We can get to the sinless part later. Simple question, because it's part of the thesis of the debate. I love it. If you concede one of the points of the thesis, that's perfectly fine. You agree she's the mother of God then. You have no problem with that.
I have no problem with her being the mother of Jesus, who is God incarnate.
Right. There you go. You're calling her the mother of Jesus. You disagree with the title Theotokos, which means God bearer. Right?
No, Jesus is God.
So you do agree with the title Theotokos. Your website
doesn't
agree with it.
The Bible works prophetically speaking. So no, I do not, because the Bible works prophetically. Even if there's a reference to the bearer of God, which is Jesus before Jesus, I mean, that's just a prophecy then.
I'm very confused. I
have no problem with Jesus being God or being born of Mary. That does not in any way create her being sinless or perpetual virginity.
We're going to, if you want to debate perpetual virginity, we can do it. It won't go well for you. I'll tell you that right now.
She had five or six kids.
No, she didn't, because we can talk about the Greek word used for them there. Two different Greek words. They're called Adelphos, Adelphi, and then they're identified as Syngeneuson.
Well, let's do that one next.
We can do that one right now.
Sinlessness first.
What does Syngeneuson mean? They're identified as relatives, not as literal blood children of Mary. But anyway, let's get back to this.
Let's do the sinless one first. We'll get to it.
Let's move away from 2 Samuel 6, because you agree there that it's referring to Yahweh. Thus, Mary is the mother of Yahweh right there in Luke 1. You don't agree with the title Theotokos, which means mother of God. Why would you disagree with that title if it simply means God bearer, that she is the mother of God? Why would you not agree with that title?
I disagree with the way that it's spun then. I mean, mother of God, sure, but God was incarnated in a physical body under a sinful woman, a mortal woman,
in order to be
a human man.
Right, but we're not talking about her sinlessness right now. We know she's mortal, but we're talking about her being Theotokos. That has nothing to do with
the mother of Jesus and God, sure. Although God pre-existed her.
Right,
so
of course.
It's a little confusing with time and chronology.
But I don't think it gets confusing. It has nothing to do with her sinlessness or the physical body. We agree with it being a physical body. It means that she bore God. So how do you disagree? Let me widen it. In Matthew's gospel, Isaiah 7, this is in your opening. In Matthew's gospel, Isaiah 7, you clearly know that, is being fulfilled in our Lord's virginal conception and his birth. Matthew's gospel, the Greek reads as thus. In fact, let me pull it up. It says, Matthew 1:23, look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son. They shall name him Emmanuel, which means God with us. Right there, we have bearer of a son. We have the Greek word tekos. Okay. And then you have the Greek word theos. You combine those, tikto or tekita, however you want to pronounce it. You combine them. And what do you get? You get Theotokos. That's what you get. It's right there biblically. And you're agreeing with what it means, yet you presented a whole article disagreeing and saying that Ephesus is when it first originated. So which one is it, Dustin? You agree with it or you disagree with it?
Actually, I agree with the fact that she is the bearer of God. However, even Roman Catholics outlawed the worship of Mary before it was constituted.
We don't worship Mary.
We'll get to that.
I would love for evidence that we worship Mary. It's my cross-examination, though. You can get to me in yours. And
we will.
I promise you this. It won't go well for you if you think you're going to prove a point that you worship. But we're going to continue. And it's not going to go well. You agree with Theotokos, yet in your opening, you didn't. You criticized Theotokos, yet now you're agreeing with it. So I guess you conceded a massive part of the Marian portion, which I don't know how I'm going to go 45 minutes. If you've given me a massive part of that, you just agree to her being Theotokos. Or do you disagree that she's the God-bearer?
I agree that she is the God-bearer of Jesus.
Okay.
God in a man in a
right.
form,
yeah, what? So
which
then
is an important
you,
context,
so
because you're trying
why,
to make her the creator of God.
Where I would like for you to quote one statement in a catechism or anything where they try to make her the creator of God. Where?
See,
name
God,
one.
God has no mother or originator.
Oh, hold on, Dustin. I don't, well, all due respect, my friend, and I'm not being disrespectful. I don't care for your opinion. Give me a proof that we call her the creator of God. Give me a proof.
You call her the mother of God, therefore God was Theotokos. Born of her.
Theotokos, you just agreed with me on Theotokos. That doesn't mean creator of God.
I agree with you in the context that a mortal woman created God's physical body on earth
after
God created this mortal woman.
Show me one quote, buddy, where we say that she's the creator of God. One quote from a pope, a father, a catechism. Give me one.
I'll find it in our cross-examination.
Oh, my goodness. Good
I've
luck there, buddy.
Too much to look at here to find it, so but I will.
Let's move on. You say there that Ephesus was an innovation here in calling Mary Theotokos, Mother of God, and that you made an incredible statement. You said, when Cyril, the Bishop of Alexandria, had openly embraced the cause of Isis, the Egyptian goddess, and had anthropomorphized her into Mary, the Mother of God, and the Trinitarian controversy had taken place. Here's my first question to you. Where on earth at Ephesus was the Trinitarian controversy even in play? Do you even know what happened at Ephesus?
I'm vaguely familiar with the events. The Trinitarian thing is not something that I've actually studied that deeply.
So I would like for you, since you quoted this in your opening, and I'm going to hold your feet to the fire. Quoted it in your opening, and you've said it many times before. You said Cyril, who, by the way, for us, he's a master of Christology and Mariology, embraced the cause of Isis. I would love for you to quote where he does that. And I don't care about any book, third or second or fourth hand resource. I want you to quote him. Where does he do that?
Isis Unveiled is the book. It has the source.
It's quoted them. That is a secondhand source. Where on earth does Cyril ever do that? And by the way, I looked at the book. He doesn't quote him. You are wrong.
Okay, fair enough. Then until I can prove that point, then I'll try to concede that point, I guess.
How many times does St. Cyril ever even mention Isis?
The pagan injection is obvious no matter how you look at it, from the symbolism to the presence to everything.
Cyril was not alone
in this. Even if he was not the primary culprit. However, I stand by that quote. I think that it is probably accurate.
Wonderful. Then give me the quote.
Catholicism has less credibility.
Don't ramble. It's my cross-examination.
Very well.
Don't ramble. And you can hold me to the same standard. I won't ramble, I promise. Okay. I want a quote. You haven't provided a quote. Give me a quote. You're quoting from a book. So
yes, I am.
Let me educate you. I'm going to educate you. He mentions Isis in one work, and the reason I'm being fair with you, my friend. I'm being fair. You claim a lot of very strong things in your website with zero source material. That is not how scholarly work is done. And when you come to a debate, you better have scholarly resources. He mentions Isis in one work, in his On Adoration. And how would you know that if the work is not even in English? I looked it up because I can read Greek. That work is not in English. And I translated that work to read it. And all he does is criticize Isis, trashes Isis. So how can you tell the audience in your 25-minute opening over and over that he is the one that introduced it and he introduced Mary as the figure of Isis if Cyril over and over trashes that pagan figure?
I am happy to concede one particular fact that may be wrong. However, the bulk of the evidence still stands. So if indeed this is
the
wrong,
bulk of the evidence?
To me, I will delete that portion of the article, but there's still a book's worth of article left on the paganism and injection.
And you can get to that in your cross-examination. Thus far, it isn't going well for you thus far. We can see multiple errors being made, including on Theotokos, which, by the way, you claim it was made there at Ephesus for the first time. Are you aware that was used over 300 years before Ephesus, the title?
I was not.
Okay.
Although I think that you made that point earlier, so I am now.
Okay, wonderful.
However, the bearer of God is a title that many probably cultures have used, and Latin was a Roman language, and Rome had many other gods and goddesses until Jesus, so
my friend, not even part and partial to the debate, so I really could care less.
I disagree entirely.
Well, then, in your cross-examination...
use the word for other gods, it was in the vocab.
Oh,
that's fair.
Goodness, Dustin. Now you made a big mistake because Origen uses it for Mary, not using
Origen
it merely
was
in the vocab.
Pagan. He was an occultist.
Okay, you think Origen was a pagan. What about the Subtuum Presidium? What about that document? Was that a pagan document?
You glitched a little bit. The what document?
What about the Subtuum Presidium? Was that a pagan document?
One is that? I do.
What about Hippolytus of Rome? Hippolytus of Rome, St. Irenaeus of Lyon, who all call her the Mother of God. Are they all pagan?
Probably, yeah. Certainly Origen was. He tried to inject Gnostic teachings.
I agree. Origen was a heretic. But there's not a single, every single early father, were they all pagan? You got Gregory the Wonderworker? You got St. Irenaeus of Lyon?
the actual founding fathers were the apostles of the Bible. Everyone who came after that, many of those so-called church fathers and saints were mass murderers
Sola Scriptura, right? And they use those two words when put together mean Theotokos, that Mary's the God-bearer. So you've got it biblically as well.
The view of
But you've already Mary, agreed on that. You've already agreed on that.
The view of Mary has changed since Rome began. How is that possible?
You, my friend, can try to get to that in your cross-examination.
I would like to rebut something.
You can like to rebut all you want. You're not rebutting during my cross-examination. You can do it during your own cross-examination or during your closing. You made a statement, and I love this one. As part of the Catholic Church being the Whore of Babylon, no man is God, official Catholic doctrine, Pope is God incarnate. I would like for you to quote one doctrine, one statement of any Pope, any for me. And I don't want you to quote books for me, my friend, Isis Unveiled or any of these funny books. I want you to quote an actual firsthand resource. That is how scholarly debates are done. One firsthand resource where the Pope is ever claiming to be God incarnate.
I'll find it. Off the top of my head, it'll take me some time.
Well, man, you're going to have quite the hill to climb there. You're never going to find it. You're never, ever going to find it. So are you looking right now? Okay, let me hear it.
Let's see. Give me a second. I found the section.
So I'm going to give you a few seconds and I'm going to ask the next question because my time is running.
Well, it's in the title. However, Vicar of Christ is official Catholic dogma. I have to find it. It's in the law of Catholicism.
It's in the canon law. I've got the canon law book right here next to me. Quote it from me. I've got the canon law right here. Dustin, you're out of your element, my friend.
I don't remember every single bit of Catholic canon law, my friend.
You can look it up online. I'm being very nice with you, Dustin. You're really out of your element. You claim to be a scholar online, and you made the claim in your videos. Line them up and I'll knock them down. Well, I'm lined up waiting to be knocked down. Quote that for me from the canon law. You claimed right now that you have it in canon law. I've got the canon law, the Roman canon law right here. Quote for me that the Pope is God incarnate.
When I can't find a thing, I'm happy to say test this and, you know, test all
things.
Well,
goodness, we've been testing my whole cross-examination. You got to test everything, audience. Watch out.
I won't have an answer for every question. I won't have an answer for every question.
Let's move on from that one.
Neither will you, friend.
Good luck in your cross-examination. If you're going to hold to your thesis, if you're going to hold to that thesis, it's going to continue being a roast, my friend. The cross-examination, the Whore of Babylon, you claim on your webpage that Constantine incorporated paganism, and I'm just reading it directly, into, you said, a quasi-Christian pagan religion, confirming the Catholic Church is a Whore of Babylon. You know, I got to ask you, how is this possible that the Whore of Babylon is the Catholic Church and Constantine incorporated paganism and created the church? If the whore is spoken of, is around at the time of St. John. How is that possible?
It was not around at the time of St. John. It was a reference to the Revelation, Book of Revelation.
Okay, let's look at Revelation. Let's look at the Book of Revelation. Let's look at Revelation 17, 1-4. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand, full of abominations and filthiness in her fornication. In Revelation 17:1, it says, then one of the seven angels who's had the seven bowls came and said to me, come, I will show you the judgment of the great whore who is seated on many waters. Dustin, the Greek for the whore sitting is a verb. It's a participle in the present tense. How are you telling me? How can you tell your audience Constantine founded the Catholic Church 400 years later or 300 years later, excuse me, if John is telling you in the present tense, the whore is right there in front of him?
John is not using that present tense in this context. And you know, we can get into the etymology of the words.
He's not
However,
using
I would
the
reject
tense?
That interpretation. Exactly. Yeah, I would reject that interpretation.
Tell us the tense of the Greek if he's not using the present tense. What is the tense of the Greek?
You're welcome to pull up the etymologies and the breakdowns and the concordances.
I've got the Greek open. I have got it open. Okay, I'm not going to waste my time. Definitely. Okay. Yeah. Let me open it up here. Let me share my screen. Here we go.
Let's see what you have in terms of etymology.
Right there. So here you have Revelation 17:1. You have the great whore seated on many waters. Now, I'm not going to go through every concordance. You can do that in your cross-examination if you want. You're telling me that I'm wrong about the Greek participle when I can read Greek? How many years of Greek have you taken, Dustin?
So, well, in rebuttal, I would just ask, how could this be happening in that context?
Dustin,
it's obviously
I asked you
an
a question.
End times context.
How many years of Greek have you taken?
Zero.
Yet you call yourself a Bible scholar. Where we read right here, the great whore is
an undefeated
seated.
In debate Bible scholar.
Well, this is, you're going to put yourself at that one, the big fat one today, my friend.
We'll see.
The great whore who is seated on many waters, right here, you've got a verb that is in the participle. It's right here. Megales, tes, kasemenes, epi, udator, polon. It's in the present tense. So the whore is right there before him.
Can we consider context?
Yeah. What's the context,
then,
Dustin?
When do the seven bowls of judgment happen in the book of Revelation?
So, yeah, well, that's during your cross-examination. You can ask me those questions.
I just asked the context and you have no answer.
No.
This is cross.
Well, this is my cross-examination.
Back and forth. Well, it's back and forth. It's my back.
I ask you. I ask you. You answer me. It's not back and forth to where you ask me. You can do that in your cross-examination.
This
so
is
right
my
here,
answer. You're ignoring the context of the line that came before. What you're saying is back
so
then.
So the line that
it's
came before,
not.
Show me where there's a past tense here. If he tells you
Revelation
the whore is before
17:1 is future tense.
It's future tense? It's in the present. The verb is a participle.
Revelation 17:1. How has the world ended? Has the resurrection happened?
Dustin,
no, the revelation is future tense.
We're talking about, I don't believe
it's a
the
prophecy
whole book
of the future.
I don't believe that. I don't believe the whole
book
of Revelation.
Are you a preterist then?
No, I never said that, Dustin. Dustin,
that's what preterism is, the belief that this already happened.
Stick to the question, Dustin. No going off on tangents.
Stick to the context of the question.
So show me here in the context where this is past tense. Show me.
I didn't say past. I said future tense. You said past
tense. Oh, it's future tense. Yet the verb is in
the
present. It's the
book of Revelation, brother. Of course it's future tense. It hasn't happened.
What early church fathers believed that the book of Revelation was all futuristic?
All of them.
Name one. Name one that wrote a commentary.
You're
name
a preterist.
One.
This was actually warned about in scripture.
No, Dustin, I never said I was a preterist. Don't go off topic. I'm asking you a question.
Well, 2 Thessalonians 2:2.
Dustin, I asked you about an early church father.
And
not
I answered your question.
Thessalonians.
2 Thessalonians 2:2. The occasion of Paul's writing to the Thessalonians was to correct some of the errors concerning the end times that the believers had heard from false teachers.
Right,
among
Dustin,
the
but that doesn't
was
prove
that the day of Dustin, the Lord had already come.
Dustin, that does not prove that another book.
Proves it.
No,
future
it doesn't.
Tense.
Thessalonians, you're telling me a book written by St. Paul proves that a book written by John is going to be future tense? Stick to the context of Revelation 17:1-4. I'm telling you the Greek is in the present, and you're telling me this is futuristic?
And
on
I'm
the basis
telling
of what?
You that the seven angels who had the seven bowls hasn't happened yet, clearly.
But yet he is seeing that, and he's claiming the whore is presently seated.
He
but,
is in a vision.
And he's seeing this
of
in the vision.
Future.
Where does it say it's a future vision?
When it talks about how it's the book of Revelation and the whole context of the entire book.
He says this is the book of Revelation. This is my context. Read one passage, Dustin, where he says this is in the future. He talks about the birth of Christ, too. Is that in the future in Revelation?
Wow. Okay. So are you arguing that the book of Revelation is not future tense?
I
don't have a
that
defense
it's all,
for that right now.
I'm arguing that it's all tenses, Dustin. You don't have a defense for your main argument, Dustin.
I don't have a defense that you don't believe that the book of Revelation is future tense. I
do
not expect that way.
I believe some
of my debating,
I believe some of it is, Dustin. But that, Dustin, this is not a debate on the tense, on the whether it's future, past,
it
present,
is.
Or whatever.
You're arguing future tense, and I'm or past tense. I'm arguing future tense on the same passage.
Dustin, you claimed that Constantine founded the Catholic Church, the Whore of Babylon. Yet John physically sees the whore, and the Greek uses the present tense. And you're telling me it's futuristic. How is that possible, Dustin?
I'm talking about the prophecy of the end times that was including the bowls of wrath.
My friend, he's telling
entire,
you the whore is right there before his eyes. But
in a vision of the future.
Where does he say it's a vision of the future? Where, Dustin?
Okay. We'll have to, I guess, come back to this point in terms of debating. And I would love to have this as a debate.
By,
is
by
is
the way,
book of Revelation future or past tense? I'd love to have that debate with you.
But Dustin, I just told you, I agree. I think it's all tenses. I think it's present. I think it uses past events. And I think futuristic.
So then
well.
We're in
I'm
agreement.
Not
that's a future tense.
We're not
we're
in agreement here. We're not in agreement here. This is it. It depends how the Greek is used. It depends how the Greek is used. And depending how the Greek is used, that's what, I mean, are you going to argue that when it talks about the woman giving birth to Christ, the Messiah, that that's in the future? How? How's that possible? Christ was already born, Dustin. I mean, we got to be serious here, Dustin. I mean, let's be a little bit serious here.
Let's be serious then.
I mean, let me move on to Mary's, the grace that Mary was in possession of. Let me pause for a moment to see how much time I got. I don't want to abuse of my time. 22 minutes. Okay. In Luke 1:28, in Luke 1:28 and Ephesians 1, you've got a particular root Greek word there. The root charis, as I said, and the Greek word for Mary, the Greek word used for her in the vocative, kikaritomene, that word used in Ephesians 1, which is the only other area where it is used, is talking about a particular kind of grace, an all sinless, stainless kind of grace. How can you argue that Mary was a sinner if this particular kind of grace we are reading, that Mary is in full possession of this particular kind of grace?
My turn?
Yeah.
Okay, so as far as the sinless argument, both pagan tradition and Catholicism teach the Mother of Heaven was born without sin. However, being a descendant of Adam, Mary had inherited sin. Romans 5:12 says, wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. Galatians 3:22 says, but the scripture hath concluded all under sin, that the promise of faith by Jesus Christ might be given to them that believe. It was not until 1864 AD that Mary was even proclaimed sinless against Dustin, these verses in the Bible, Dustin, such as Romans 3:10 to 19 and Romans 3:23.
Dustin, you even got that wrong. It's 1854, Ineffabilis Deus. You even got that one wrong. But you're wrong about that.
10 years off.
You're talking about
these dates could be a little bit off.
They're all off and they're all wrong.
I did say that the dates could be a little bit off because there's conflicting dates on these. Well, it doesn't mean that it didn't happen. So it's sort of arguing to a moot point.
You're off on the papal bull, but you're about 1,300 years off on her being declared sinless, as that happened way before then. Have you ever read the Tome of Leo, Dustin?
Pope John Paul II concedes that the church historically did not, Dustin, hold a Roman Catholic view of Mary.
I do not agree with you, Dustin. I asked you a question, Dustin. Have you read the Tome of Leo? Simple question.
No.
Tome of Leo is from four.
Yeah. I don't care about any of the Catholic propaganda. It's all fake news.
Dustin, you hold a still sola scriptura. I'm going to
Rome invented fake news, man. Yeah. Rome invented it.
Well, so far, we've seen that you are the king of it. Thus far, we've seen you're the man when it comes to fake news, Dustin.
Check it out.
So, Dustin.
Learning against learning.
You claim that in 18, let me give you 1854. Let me correct it for you. That this was created, yet we have it taught in 451. What on earth is happening, Dustin?
Pope John Paul II before that said, quote, many centuries were necessary to arrive at the explicit definition of the revealed truths concerning Mary.
Explicit
definition. He said this in 1995.
Explicit definition. We can agree there, but the sinlessness of Mary was not what he was talking about. It was taught in 451, yet you tell the audience it's 1854. By the way,
I said earlier the dates could be off a little bit.
Yeah, you're right.
Fine.
By 1,000 years.
Send me the source. I'd be happy to correct the date.
I just told you. Tome of Leo, Council of Chalcedon.
I can't just trust you. You're Catholic, man.
1,400 years. No big deal, man. I'm just a little bit off. Dustin, you're the king of fake news, brother.
Catholics invented fake news. I'm broke for telling the truth about fake news.
You're picking the baton up, brother.
I'm actually quite famous internationally for being a truth teller against fake news.
Well, you're also famous for being undefeated. Line them up, you said. You're a biblical scholar. Biblical scholar who can't read a lick of Greek. I asked you Ephesians 1 and Luke 1:28. If you're a biblical scholar, you better know the languages.
God says you don't need any man to teach you the Bible.
Oh, well, funny enough, was that written in Greek or Hebrew? Oh, you read a Bible scholar in any translation.
He said it in any language. You don't need a teacher to learn the Bible.
So earlier I'd asked you
a Greek teacher included.
I had asked you earlier, you're very wrong there. You're told in 2 Peter that no interpretation is a matter of private interpretation. You do need a teacher. The church is also called the pillar and foundation of truth. Your private interpretation doesn't pass, brother. I asked you about Luke 1, and in a bit you can bring up a passage and we'll exegete it. We'll see how you do there. In Luke 1:28, I quoted it earlier, and I quoted, you ain't going to be sharing during my time. This is my cross-examination.
I'm rebutting what you said.
Yeah. Well, this is my cross-examination, not your rebuttal. Not your rebuttal, brother.
What you just said.
You ain't going to do this during my class. You can do it during yours. So you brought up Romans, which you can get to that in your cross examination. But I asked you a particular question about relating to the sinlessness of Mary from Luke 1:28 and Ephesians 1:6. I showed you how that
interpretation.
Then rebut it. If the root word from Ephesians 1, if the root word from, yeah, keep saying it over and over, it might become true. If the root word from Ephesians 1 is showing you that particular kind of grace is an all stainless, sinless kind of grace. I'm looking at the Greek in front of me. And that is
a second and third witness, by the way.
And that is the grace that Mary is full of, kecharitomene. How can Mary then fall under the condemnation of being a sinner? Answer it from what I've asked you. Don't go off on
a tangent. Two or three witnesses are required for truth. So here's multiple witnesses that she's not sinless. Romans 5:12, Galatians 3:2-2.
So you can't answer from this.
Romans 3:10-19 and Romans 3:23. All of those say that Mary was with sin.
So, oh, they do.
Sola Scriptura.
Where do they quote Mary? What do they say Mary said?
You don't need to quote Mary to be a sinner. She was born with sin like everybody else.
Oh, and we're told that she was born with sin in the Bible.
Yes.
Oh, quote it for me.
Okay. Romans 3:10-19. As it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. There is none that understandeth. There is none that seeketh after God. They are all gone out of the way.
Go ahead. You're right.
Things are sinless. They are together become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good. No, not one. Their throat is an open sepulcher. With their tongues, they have used deceit. The poison of asp is under their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways, and in the way of peace they have not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. Now we know that what things soever the law saith, it saith to them who are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped and all the world may become guilty before God. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God.
So Mary's under the old law. Mary's under the old law.
Everyone is under the old law.
Oh, really? Everybody is under the old law, even Mary.
Yes.
Oh, Torah, which is why. So nobody's under the new covenant of Christ then.
The word covenant was injected. And in fact, Paul kept Torah and taught Torah, just like Jesus, who said not one iota of the law would pass away until heaven and earth pass away. He died to bring us to the law.
We're not going to talk about the law right now. I'm asking you if Mary is under the condemnation of the law.
Everyone is under the condemnation of the law in as far as they do not have faith.
So in Romans 5, where it talks about all being under sin, does it mean all without exception?
Yes. For that.
Really? So even Christ.
Sinned.
Even
all
Christ
humans
was a sinner.
Have
then.
Sinned.
Even Christ, who was a sinner then.
All have sinned. Yes. All have sinned. Not Jesus, who was part of all. It's referring to humans.
He uses the Greek word. Christ was fully human and fully God.
It's referring to the rest of us who were not born sinless.
Dustin, it's referring to actual sin. It's not talking about those that are born with sin. It's talking about actual sin. Are you telling me pas, the Greek word, is in reference to all? So that would include our Lord?
Sin. That includes that we have sinned.
Where does it say all born? It's talking about those that commit actual sins, doesn't it?
Romans 5:12, wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned.
Our
Jesus
Lord was
not
a man.
A man in the normal sense.
What? He was not a man in the normal sense?
He was a mortal man, but he was also God. Therefore, he was pure and without sin.
You would admit that there is an exception to that Greek word for all there?
Unless the Bible says otherwise, then no.
Well, the Bible very clearly doesn't say, okay, well,
the Bible says Jesus
really
was without
all.
Sin. It does not say Mary was without sin.
Well, I just
and I gave you five verses that said she
Dustin,
was.
Dustin, I just quoted Luke 1:28 and Ephesians 1, which proves that she was without sin, and you're hopping to other verses.
Yes,
I'm showing you, hold on. Yeah, in the Bible, I'm showing you that just like our Lord, that there's an exception, there's also an exception for Mary by virtue of what Luke 1:28 says about her. And I'm waiting for you to rebut that. Rebut the Greek of Luke 1:28, because I agree and you agree. All does not mean all here in Romans.
The Bible includes exceptions for Jesus. It does not include exceptions for Mary or anyone else.
I just provided the exception for Mary.
Your interpretation, I disagree with.
Then rebut it then. You disagree with mine. I believe it's a proper interpretation.
I think that
it.
The burden of proof is on you because the Bible doesn't claim what you say it does.
I just laid it out. The burden of proof. I read it. Luke 1. Let me do it again, Dustin. Let me lay
Please.
It out again.
Okay.
So you believe the burden of proof is on me. And I keep showing you there are exceptions to Romans. Our Lord is an exception. We're told And we're told Mary, by the way, I don't believe Mary is sinless. No Catholic believes she's sinless the way our Lord is. That's a sinlessness by nature. Mm-hmm. There's a very big difference. Hers is by grace. So let me go back to Luke 1:28. Man,
then we're all sinless.
We were, very good point. We were all created. We were meant to be created that way, if not for the fall. That is what Ephesians is talking about. That particular,
then every man.
Hold on, I'm not done. Let me read it so I can. I want to ask it to you. Let me formulate my question. As Ephesians 1, it talks about a particular kind of grace that was lost in the garden. There's only two areas where that particular root word are found. Ephesians 1, Luke 1. Mary is full of that particular kind of grace. My argument is, and I can quote Greek scholars and Greek fathers, that by virtue of the Greek word kecharitomene, the vocative greeting for Mary, the only other area you have that root word for that kind of grace, that is an all sinless, stainless kind of grace that you find in Ephesians. How on earth can Mary be part of the sinful people if this term is very clearly used for her? It would show her to be an exception as well.
Because the scriptures are clear about who is sinless and who is not. It then clearly references it. Jesus as sinless. I'm just not convinced by your arguments. I remain unconvinced.
Well, if you
I find
are
them
not
uncompelling.
If they are not compelling, do me a favor and rebut it then. Rebut it.
I just did. I've gave you multiple verses 3-4 times now.
And I'm telling you there are
people other than Jesus were born with
but
sin.
But you agree with me that the all there doesn't always mean all.
And I also pointed out that Catholics did not even teach this for a long time. It was a much later teaching in history. And Pope John Paul II conceded this point.
Dustin. So you, when you mentioned that, you showed that there were exceptions. And I agreed with our Lord. You said, well, you got to go elsewhere to show there's exceptions. Oh, hold on.
Yeah.
Cost doesn't always mean all. And I agree. So it doesn't blanket mean all. And I said, I can show you where Mary is also an exception. You said, well, I don't agree with your reading. Well, prove my reading wrong.
I don't think that you've proven it right.
How have I proven it wrong? By the context of Luke 1:28 and Ephesians 1. How have I proven it wrong?
Luke 1:28. And the angel came into her and said, hell, thou art highly favored. Yahweh is with thee.
That's a pretty terrible translation. That's a pretty terrible translation.
That's the King James Version, which is more reliable than the Catholic Version, although still not perfect.
There is no Catholic Version, Dustin. There is no
official. The Douay Rheims and the Latin Vulgate are the official Catholic versions of Latin Vulgate.
No, Dustin, you're incorrect. Dustin, the Latin is the official Latin translation, Dustin. There's a very big difference. And you're wrong. The Douay Rheims is not the official English one, Dustin. Although,
well, it's a
I think the Douay, according to who? According to it's, who, I love it, but it's not the best one.
Proportionally, I mean, more Catholics use that than anything else. So Douay Rheims is
I don't
sort of
agree
like their KJV.
I know a lot
I
of Catholics
statistics
don't use
bear,
it.
I think the statistics will bear that out. Quote but I don't believe that Luke says what you say it says.
Oh, then if the
I'm
Greek
English,
of Luke
so
1, if
I'm
the
English,
Greek,
I speak English, and we can go into the word etymologies, and I agree that
then
those
let's
are
do it. Then show
but
me
by,
how
by
I'm wrong.
Multiple witnesses, your method, your theory here is wrong by 4 or 5 different witnesses. You have one
I
or
need
two
you to
possible
show me.
Witnesses where if you look into the Greek and the possible translations of it, it might say this. I mean, that's not conclusive, nor is that nearly as strong as 5 or 6 verses, 4 or 5 verses that I just gave you.
And I just told you that I agree with all those other verses. Number one, we don't believe Mary is righteous. And Mary's not the one being condemned there. Number two, we don't believe Mary's under the old law, but that's a whole other debate. Number three, you agreed with me that all, passer, doesn't mean literally blanket statement all. Our Lord is an exception. And I'm showing you Luke 1 shows that Mary is also an exception. You're saying you'll have none of it that I'm wrong.
Well, so, I just find it uncompelling versus what I showed you, multiple verses that say all, she is okay. A sinner.
So
now, you can trust the Greek if you want. For
oh, I'm asking you to refute
audience,
the Greek.
But
Dustin,
this
I'm asking you to refute the Greek. You have
don't need to refute the Greek.
You don't need to refute it. Let's move on to another question. You don't need to refute the Greek. Dustin, there are
because
very
it's
few.
It's your interpretation, and it may not be every other Greek interpretation.
I can quote Greek scholars. I can quote Greek ancient fathers as well. But I want to move
you can
another
quote
question.
Catholic.
These pagan are not Catholic. Sources. These are.
I stick to sola scriptura. So,
Dustin, I asked you to prove it from the Bible alone, from the scriptura alone.
Romans 5:12, Galatians 3:2, Romans 3:10-19, Romans 3:2-3.
And those got smoked, Dustin. You weren't able to deal with them. Let me move to another question.
Sinned and come short of the glory of God.
Yeah, personal sin. Our Lord is an exception. Mary is also an exception. Very clearly.
All have sinned.
Yeah, and it also tells us that all die. Not all have died. have all died?
Unless the Bible clearly says, like it says everybody died on earth except Noah and his family. All life perished. All flesh was corrupted.
No, it doesn't.
Clearly,
Enoch
Noah was
and
not. All flesh
die.
Was corrupted.
No, it didn't. Dustin.
That's not what I said.
Enoch and
I didn't
Elijah
talk about
don't
Noah.
die. Okay, yeah, but
I
the
didn't
Bible
say that.
doesn't.
Of course, Enoch and Elijah don't die. I know that.
Okay, good.
But
Good,
it tells
good.
you
Okay,
that.
okay.
It doesn't say Mary doesn't die.
I believe Mary died. I think Mary died.
Okay.
I agree. I think Mary died. But anyway, I'm going to move to another question.
Okay.
Because you can grill me on that. You keep bringing up Sola Scriptura over and over.
Yes.
What Bible version do you hold to? What Bible did you use? The King James?
No.
What do you use? You put it together yourself?
I use the primarily as my backbone, the Dead Sea Scrolls, the Qumran original Christian library.
I mean, let me ask you a question, my friend. Is your desire just to bury yourself? You do realize those include deuterocanonical books. And your webpage, you condemn them. What planet are you from, brother?
I do not. What do you, be specific.
You condemned, you claimed the Catholic Church added books later. And then removed books, you claimed.
They did.
You claimed, okay.
They admit when, this.
Oh, really? Quote yeah. one for me. Quote one source.
The Council of Nicaea and the Council of Ephesus. They decided which books
wow.
would be in there. They took
really?
A third of them out.
Dustin, yeah. I will give you to your PayPal $5,000 right now. Quote any canon for me from Nicaea and Ephesus where any book is removed. They don't even talk about the canon there, Dustin.
Not at the
They don't
Nicaea,
even talk
the
about
Ephesus
it.
And on. There's other councils that I can't remember
Dustin,
the names off the top of
Dustin,
my head.
Quote
there were
Nicaea.
Multiple, two or three or four councils, not in Nicaea, but the other two later, they changed the books.
Nicaea didn't talk about it.
And they
Ephesus
also
didn't talk about it.
I can see that.
Okay, you can see Nicaea. Dustin, quote from Ephesus where they talk about the canon. Quote it for me.
I don't know off the top of my head. People should test this.
You're claiming it off of your webpage. Brother, let me be fair with you.
I have curated an archive from hundreds of sources, thousands
of
sources throughout history. I
saw your, and you got to provide references, my friend.
And they're
all
there.
It's
a source.
You don't quote any references,
archive.
Dustin. Dustin.
These were all quotes. I mean, everything
Dustin,
on there almost is a quote.
Let me be very fair with you. You need a little bit of humility, my friend. That is why I came to debate you. I saw your comments over and over. Line them up. I'll knock them down. Come on, Dustin. Let me be very real. You told David that, and you've been smoked from the beginning today. Right now, in your cross,
ooh.
It's going to get worse. It's going to
get
worse.
You manipulate words in Greek, and you tell us that that's what
wrong.
It means. I don't believe you.
Prove
and
me
as
wrong.
I said, Catholicism has been known for creating fake news and lying and persecuting real Christians since the beginning. Their credibility is brokered than the Ten Commandments.
Anyway, so I would like for you,
Check
going
everything.
Right back to the question, quote from, you can't quote Nicaea. You can't quote Ephesus. Which council removed those
I can
books?
Quote, I can quote Council of Ephesus.
Quote from me
where
a book was removed.
Once cried, great is Diana of the Ephesians, according to Acts 19:34.
We're talking about the canon of scripture. Where were
we're
books
talking
removed?
About the Catholic canon, which is a pagan entity and has been since its inception.
Where were the books removed, Dustin? At what council?
I can't remember the exact councils of
but
books
you,
removed,
you
but they
told
were,
us
and it was from
Nicaea?
The Catholic Church, so you're arguing a moot point.
Dustin,
I may not have every little detail, but that doesn't mean I'm wrong.
You don't even have one. You told us Nicaea and Ephesus.
Test it.
You can't quote from Nicaea
Roman
or Ephesus. So which one?
Removing books.
Which one, Dustin?
Right, let's Google Roman Catholics.
Google.
Google's
your best friend.
Books. Let's Google this. Let's Google this. Just off the top of our
Dustin.
Head here.
Dustin, I just wrote a book in the canon. I just wrote it. Where I translated tons of documents from Greek to English. You better be ready when you make the statements you make, my friend. Quote one council, Dustin. I need one. Google's not going to save you. Because I know this material better than I know the wrinkles in my hand. Quote it. Give me one.
I'm looking. But people should test it, even if I can't find it.
They're going to test, and they're going to go to your webpage, and they're going to realize how I've smoked it today.
Okay. Test it. So, I mean, obviously, the different
You're Googling. Have you gotten the Google yet? Have you gotten it?
Oh, it's a long article.
Maybe you got to ask Siri for help. Alexa,
well,
brother.
For example, as Tertullian told us, the Book of Enoch was removed. And I don't remember where exactly, but this is from Tertullian, one of those founding fathers.
Quoted from
I don't remember all of the details, but...
Dustin, where does Tertullian say Enoch was removed? Tertullian wrote in the second century. Where does he claim Enoch was removed?
I'll find it.
Good luck. Good luck. I got 3 minutes left, so you claim that the Ethiopic Bible... It was the only Bible that had what book? You claimed it was, I think you made a claim on a certain book, right?
What? I was claiming about Tertullian.
Oh, well, I can save you the trouble. You're not going to find anything at Tertullian. Who, by the way, was a Montanist heretic. But you won't find anything in him either. Dustin, I got 3 minutes left. Let me ask you. If you think you got something there, let's go. Let's go with the canon. If you think you got something there.
He wrote, let's see, the Book of Enoch was considered a scripture in the Epistle of Barnabas, 16:4, and by many of the early church fathers, such as Athenagoras, Dustin. Clement, Irenaeus, and Tertullian, who wrote C200, that the Book of Enoch had been rejected by the Jews because it contained prophecies containing Christ.
By the Jews, not the early Christians.
The Jews have controlled Rome since the time of Nero or Julius.
And you haven't proven that today. So let's
Julius
go right
was
back
betrayed
to
by
canon.
Brutus because he was in the pocket of the Jews, just like politicians today.
Let's go back to the canon.
The first Jesuit was a Jew.
Those little
the Pope side today talks, is a Jew.
Those little side talks might work on somebody else. They don't work on me, Dustin. I've been debating for a long time. I'm holding your feet to the fire in the canon.
You are going to win the arguments, I admit, probably Dustin, on the Greek wording. I'm going to win 90% of the other arguments.
I am going to finish you off. And I don't want to hear you on David's show again. I don't want to hear you.
Accumulation is going to be massively in my favor.
I don't want to hear you on David's show again saying to line him up and you'll knock him down because you have done nothing today for your case. I'm going to ask you my final question because I got 2 minutes left. It's my cross-examination. Fine. My final question today is you claimed that it was in 1864 where the church officially began teaching that Mary was without sin. Yet we have this teaching found in multiple early church documents, including a document from the 100s, which talks about Mary as being the fruit of righteousness. Do you reject all early Christian documents?
The fruit of righteousness does not mean sinless.
It's talking about her birth. The fruit of justice means she has no original sin.
That fruit of justice,
dikaiosunes, her being born with full justice means.
Does it mean sinless?
So she's in full possession of original justice. Do you know what original justice is?
That's not what the Bible says. That's not a verse from the Bible at all.
I am
this is all your opinion.
I'm quoting the Proto-Evangelium. I'm talking about an early
sola
church
scriptura.
Document. That's why I asked you. Do you not believe in, you don't care about what any, you don't care about early church history then?
I don't care about anybody after the Bible said about the Bible.
Okay.
Because all they're all lying and they don't even know how to teach the law, which clearly is taught in the Bible. They
Fair
don't
enough.
Teach the giants. They don't teach the biblical earth. They don't teach anything that's truth. They're all deceived by Rome's propaganda and lies.
Dustin,
and I'm here
remember,
to break them.
Here's the one thing that I want to remind you of. Remember the title of the debate. Stick to the thesis. I don't care about any giants.
She's not sinless.
I don't care about giants. I don't care about
100% match for Whore of Babylon. And she's
the
not
law,
sinless.
Or any of those things. I really don't care about any of those stuff. Oh, yeah. You're really dominating.
I mean, I'm not trying
you
to
do a great job.
It, but I'm,
you've done
I
a great job.
Through, yeah, you might have me on a word or like 10 years off.
Oh,
a date,
I got you conceding all the
counsels. I have 100% check boxes for the Whore of Babylon.
I got you conceding all of everything. And I smoked you on the Greek of Revelation and the Whore of Babylon. But my
not
time
unless
is
you're
up.
Editing stuff together, you don't.
Yeah, sure. My time is up in my cross-examination. Good luck in yours.
Elliot, will you keep time for me, brother? Okay, so I have a couple questions. Thank you. I have a few questions just to start off, and then we'll get back into some of the other stuff. Did Mary rise from the dead?
Depends what you mean rise. Christ rose her after she died? Or do you mean, are you asking?
You have a verse.
Hold on. Do you mean that she rose on her own accord? Or whether Christ rose her from the dead and bodily assumed hers? If that's what you're getting at.
Either,
she did.
Because there's no verses for either.
Yeah, she was bodily
assumed. She
never
rose from the dead. She's in Sheol right now waiting for judgment like everyone else.
So you're gonna allow me to answer, right? You asked the question.
Either. Do you have verses? Okay.
Number one, no Catholic believes Mary rose from the dead. That's something that only our Lord did. Christ rose on his own accord from the dead, being Almighty God. Christ ascended to heaven because it is appointed for the Son of Man, Almighty God, to descend and ascend. By the way, you say that we believe Mary ascended. No, we don't. We believe
I didn't
Mary,
say you believe anything. I just asked.
It's on your webpage. We believe Mary was bodily assumed.
I didn't say that you believe that.
Okay, so Mary being, you did. You have in parentheses.
I never said that Catholics believe that Mary rose from the dead. I never said that.
You have it says ascension. You say that we believe that. We don't. We believe she was bodily assumed. And for that, you have very clear imagery.
Ascension.
No, we do not. We teach the assumption. It's a very big difference.
The assumption. We believe. Assumption.
No, it is not the same thing. It's a very big difference.
That didn't even happen until like 1950.
So that is, you're talking about the document Munificentissimus Deus. It was taught well before that. And we believe it to be biblical as well, Dustin.
It wasn't official until then. Why did it take so long?
Let me finish. Let me get my answer out, because you begin asking multiple questions. Number one, Mary being bodily assumed, bodily present in heaven is biblical. Revelation 12. We can talk about that right now if you want. That is there present. Mary is bodily present in heaven.
Having crowned. A baby?
Let me finish, Dustin. Allow me to finish my sentence.
I apologize.
Crowned in heaven. You called me out, so I'm going to call you out. Crowned in heaven. That's why I believe there's futuristic, present tense. There's all kinds of things. I don't think that language of her actually having a baby is literal, by the way. It's metaphorical. The Greek is all metaphorical. But it being defined in 1950, it was believed well before that. You find it in the liturgies of the church way before that, taught in the early church from the earliest of eras as well. You're not going to find any Catholic scholar that argues. What?
The Catholic Church taught.
Dustin, it was believed.
Not the apostles.
Dustin, it was believed by Luther, by the early reformers.
The apostles basically kept Mary in the back and barely talked to her. I mean, no, in essence, not. Even Jesus rejected when Mary wanted to talk to him. He was like, I'm busy right now with my family. And that's basically the message.
You are wrong, Dustin. You're very wrong. And let me correct you on that point as well. This wasn't created then. And it's not only in the Catholic Church, Dustin. Every apostolic church believes it. Catholic Church, Eastern Orthodox, Assyrian Church of the East, the Oriental Orthodox. You even find Lutherans and Anglicans that believe that Mary was bodily assumed.
It's my turn. So, Luke,
I'm answering. Another,
okay. You answer the question.
Feel free to cut me off. Feel free to cut me off whenever.
You said yourself that Mary did not rise from the dead. That's my first question.
On her own however, accord.
I do want to mention at all, but I do want to mention Luke 11, 27 to 28 also says, and it came to pass as he spake these things, a certain woman of the company lifted up her voice and said unto him, blessed is the womb that bare thee and the paps which thou hast sucked. But he said, yeah, rather blessed are they that hear the word of God and keep it.
Yeah, I'm going to answer that.
You know, this is the very first Mary worshiper being rejected by Jesus politely.
So I'm going to answer that since you stated that, and this is a time for cross-examination. You're wrong. The Greek there uses the Greek word manun, which he's not saying, no, don't give any honor to my mother. Not at all. He's saying, yay. And he's saying that rather those that hold to the word. Well, the very same author of Luke 11 is the author of Luke 1, where that very Greek word is used, Dustin. We read that Mary, after she heard the logos, what did she do? She said, let it be done to me according to thy word. Mary was the very first one to hear the logos, the word, and accept the word. She's more blessed than all, brother, because she heard the word.
She's very blessed.
Definitely.
She's not sinless. And also that word rather obviously means, well, not
there's
that.
No word, there's no this. Rather in the Greek. There's no rather in the Greek, Dustin.
Well, it is in the English for a reason, I imagine.
The Bible wasn't
written in English. I do trust the people who translated that word more than I do you in this context. No
Dustin,
offense.
I hate
like, for
I
example,
hate
Tyndale. I trust him. He was a master of seven languages.
Well,
died for this cause. I trust Tyndale's interpretation of rather.
Well, Dustin, let me be very honest with you. I know you're parking the bus in the English a lot. I hate to break it to you. The Bible, New Testament, was written in Greek, and the oldest manuscripts we have of the Old Testament, they're in Greek as well. And the Greek word is not there.
I agree that there is some Greek, and there was also Aramaic, and there was also Hebrew, and there's also contradicting interpretations, and there's also multiple manuscripts. We don't have the original, so we have to study
sure,
these
but
things.
There's nothing wrong with having the original
in my word studies. Let me just ask you,
and I know I can't ask, but let me just get clarification. You do believe the Bible to be inerrant, even though we don't have the original manuscript, so you don't?
I believe in biblical inerrancy. However, modern Bibles all disagree with one another. I believe the originals are perfect and flawless, and God preserved his word. So my question next is, did Mary raise the dead or perform miracles?
No, not at all. Mary's not God.
Done. Okay. Three, did Mary personally get imprisoned or tortured for her ministry?
No, Dustin.
Does the Bible give support for the notion that dead humans linger on and visit us, such as Fatima, or provide redemption?
I don't think Fatima is a demon at all. I think Fatima, by the way, it's a completely different conversation because Fatima is an apparition, and I'm not going to talk about the apparition of Fatima, but I don't think Fatima is a demon, number one. But we can debate that another day if you want. We can debate that. Dustin, we're not here to debate Fatima. We're here to debate.
Do you believe that Fatima is Mary, though?
We're not here to. Yes, I do. We're not here to debate Fatima, though. Well, hold on. I don't believe
dead humans can't come back from the dead.
I don't believe that. You don't believe what?
necromancy is forbidden. You cannot communicate with dead humans.
You said you don't believe dead humans come back from the grave?
I believe that communicating with dead humans or spirits, Dustin, appearing from the dead are forbidden by God.
There's our big divide, because the Bible doesn't call those that are dead in heaven dead. It calls them more alive than we are.
It says that they go to Sheol. I'm not done. Wait.
Dustin, I'm not done.
We don't go to heaven when we die.
I don't agree with you, Dustin. I do not agree. Let me finish my sentence, Dustin. I'm going to answer you. Those that are dead, as you call them, we don't believe. Apostolic Christians don't believe they're dead and asleep and completely out of it. We believe they're more alive than when they were here on earth, which is very
necromancy.
I'm not done, Dustin, I'm answering you from the Bible, Dustin, which is very clearly why in Revelation 5:8, you've got those saints in heaven presenting prayers of those on earth to Christ the Lord in heaven. That's intercession. They're not dead. They're more alive. The Bible uses the Greek word zao for them. They're more alive than when they were on earth. But the question about Mary, I don't think Mary does any of these kinds of miraculous things of raising the dead and what have you. It's for God and God alone, brother.
Well, they're spirits, and necromancy is forbidden by the scripture. So if
a dead person appeared to us, other than Jesus,
then it would be illegal and against God's way to talk to them. It'd be a damnable heresy, nearly.
Yeah, I don't believe Saul was cursed
for summoning a dead spirit and having a Fatima apparition in front of him.
So Dustin, the very big difference is we don't believe that they are dead. Otherwise, you're very silly.
Then who did Saul summon?
Dustin, I'm not done speaking. The very silly comparison you're making would make the transfiguration moot when three dead people appear to our Lord. This is rather silly. Those in heaven, we don't believe are dead. They're more alive than when they were on earth. Now, we also don't believe in necromancy, Dustin, which, by the way, let me be very, very clear. I have no idea how this is part of the topic, but I love the discussion. We don't believe in,
dead spirits is necromancy.
Yeah, I agree with you. You should not try to summon a dead spirit. We don't believe that those in heaven are dead. We believe they're more alive than when they were on earth, which is why the book of Revelation tells you they're interceding for us, Dustin. You got to reckon with that.
Well, there are multiple places in Sheol where the dead spirits wait judgment day, and some of those are considered an honored place of the spirits. So
you can talk about Sheol all you want.
Sheol is the afterlife of the Christian Hebrew
You can talk
story.
About Sheol all you want. What I care about is that you are making a caricature of Mariology. We don't believe a lot of these things, and we condemn necromancy, Dustin. We don't believe in summoning a dead spirit.
To pray to Mary or even communicate with Mary if she showed up would be, by de facto definition, necromancy.
I don't agree, and the Bible disagrees as well, because the Bible clearly shows that these figures are not dead. They are alive. They live on in Christ. Mark chapter 12 tells you this. Multiple verses tell you that those that have died are alive. To die in Christ is to live. You are a new creation. You are living in the Lord. The Greek word zao. Revelation 5, Dustin, we're shown those saints in heaven are aware of what's going on. In golden bowls of incense, they're receiving the prayers of the saints, and they bow down and present them to the Lord.
Do you believe that the prophets would be part of the saints?
Without a doubt.
Okay, then why?
Well, it depends which ones. Yeah, for sure.
Then why, when Samuel was resurrected from the dead, he rejected Saul if he's alive, as you say?
Because he summoned him. That's necromancy. That's why.
But he's alive, so it's not dead that you're speaking to. The same argument for Fatima.
Yeah, you're clearly dead talking about... No. It's a very big difference. You're talking about before our Lord descended into Hades to free those that were captive. This is the Old Testament, Dustin. There's a very big difference and a wide gulf, my friend. I have to be very, very fair with you. I don't think that you've read the Bible very well. You're going to the Old Testament and looking at things well before
Christ
even came.
There's no such thing as Old Testament. That's not a biblically inspired word. That page can be ripped right out along with New Testament.
You know what I mean. Whatever you want to call it.
You're trying to divide the Bible, and I think it's one book.
No.
You know what I mean? A library.
Yeah. Sure. I agree. One book. It's multiple books.
A library.
What are you talking about?
You know what I mean?
Well,
the original library, in fact. Christians kind of pioneered that.
Multiple books, but things change. Very clearly when
it's
our
one
Lord
book
comes.
Of books. It's a book of books. There's no Old Testament. There's no New Testament.
That the Catholic
Church never
gave
went
the
away
world.
With. No, the law never that, went away. In fact, the Catholics are probably behind the word covenant being edited in
Dustin,
to Hebrews 8.
Our debate is not about the law or any of that. Our debate very clearly has a thesis. And yeah, I agree with you. The Bible or a collection of books, a library, whatever you want to call it, that the Catholic Church gave the world. I completely agree with you.
Okay. So I mean, basically, we are in agreement that even the prophets who would be part of the saints are not alive in the sense that you're saying, because Samuel rejected Saul, who summoned his not alive self.
Dustin,
right?
Let me lay it out for you very clearly.
Please.
What he did.
I'm confused.
Yeah, you're very confused. What he did, my friend, was he summoned him. He called upon him. He tried to get him to come before him. We are forbidden
to
do that.
Why is that a problem?
Dustin, I'm not done. Even for those that we believe are alive in heaven in Christ, we're not to call upon them to appear before us and summon them like that. Rather, we are to call upon them to intercede for us, Dustin. There's a massive difference. He was calling upon him to bring him back. There's a big difference, my friend.
Then what scripture says we should call upon anyone other than Jesus?
Or Second Yahweh? Maccabees, book of Second Maccabees. The prophet Jeremiah Onias, the dead prophet Onias is praying for the Jewish people. You have that in Second Maccabees. In Revelation chapter, I'm not done. I'm not done, Dustin. In Revelation chapter 5, verse 8, these so-called dead saints that are in heaven, I mentioned it earlier, are receiving our prayers from earth, the saints on earth. They're going up, they receive those prayers, and then they bow down before the Lamb, Christ, worshiping him, and they present the prayers to the Lamb. That's intercession for these so-called dead figures.
Dead spirits talking to people, it seems to be forbidden by the Bible with multiple places with necromancy, with Samuel, and with the context of scripture. You're not supposed to pray to angels. It actually warns you not to pray to angels. You're not supposed to pray to shrines or icons or graven images. You're not supposed to pray to dead people or Mary. And only one name under heaven can by which you can find salvation. That's not Mary.
So unfortunately, you went on so many wild tangents that unfortunately, I'm going to have to answer those because it's not a time to pontificate. It's time for you to cross-examine me. So you mentioned shrines.
Be quickly.
Why do we go to shrines? Then don't throw out 20 things at once in. Throw out one at a time and I'll be quick.
Graven images, shrines. Call no man father. There's a lot of doctrines we could go into.
Yeah, call no man father in the sense of replacing your father in heaven. Because Paul is called a father.
That's not what it says.
That's the context. Paul is called a father, that he brings the gospel to people as a father. That's in the Bible. Secondly, graven images are condemned when they are idols. They're not condemned wholly because in the book of Ezekiel, the temple is ordained full of graven images. The Greek word there we find, I'm not done. You went in a wild rant. That Greek word there is geglumena. That means carved and etched. And there's images of angels all over the church showing you how the ideal temple should look. And why can't we have graven images in our church if this was present and ordained by God in the Old Testament? I know you don't like that word, but it's in the book of Ezekiel. There's nothing wrong with graven images. There's something wrong with idols. There's a huge difference.
It says don't have graven images, but what is the difference between graven images and idols?
Huge difference. The Bible tells you those graven images that appear there are being given latrevo, Dustin. That means worship. That's where we get the word idolatria. I'm not done. They were worshiping those images. Okay. If all images were condemned, Dustin,
in front of images, that's taught as part of their doctrine.
We worship our Lord. Let me finish.
You pray in front of dead bones,
Dustin,
and in front of graven
images. Let me finish my sentence. So when it comes to images, not all of them are condemned, because right after the condemnation of those idols, a bronze serpent is made. And what is present on the Ark of the Covenant but carved angels? All over the place are carved images. What is condemned is idolatry, Dustin. Nobody is worshiping an image. Nobody is even giving honor to an image, Dustin.
Why do Catholics bow before images and pray to icons and graven images? And where do you find anyone bowing to any of those things that you just mentioned in scripture?
So here's a very important thing. Bowing is a form of respect. All over the place, we don't believe that we're bowing and giving respect to marble or to plaster. We believe that bowing, which is a Greek from the Greek word proskuneo, that bowing goes directly either to our Lord or to a saint we're giving honor and respect to. Number two, graven images, not all of them are condemned. All throughout church history, the Jews use them all the time.
That's not
the early Christians use them.
Jews
no, hold on. The Jews used them and God approved of it. And the Jews, and the early Christians,
the word Jew didn't appear until the 1400s.
Dustin, you know what I mean. Whatever you want to call those people in the book of Ezekiel, whatever you want to call them.
Hebrews.
You know what I meant, Dustin. You know exactly what I meant. So it was never condemned, and it's not to be condemned. You need to understand the difference between idolatry and veneration. I think your inability to distinguish.
Veneration is worship. I don't want to spend too much time in this.
No, it is not, Dustin.
Anyone can look and see how Catholics treat idols, and you make up your own mind on Dustin, this and I'm compare the that. Verses in scripture. But I'm done with this topic. That. It's no, my no, no, time, no. so you I'm going yeah, to move to the next thing.
It's not your
and
time
you've
to
already addressed it. You've already pontificated quite no, long enough.
No, I did
enough,
not.
And it's
you
my
said,
turn. How much time do I have left, Elliott?
You have 20.
I'm done
minutes.
With that one. We're moving.
I don't
to
care
the next
if you're
one.
Done with that one. I don't care.
We're moving to the next one because you sort of waxed long during my time.
I'll give you an answer in 30 seconds. 30 seconds. Let me look at the time. 30 seconds. You claimed all veneration is worship. Your inability to distinguish between the Greek words dulio and latrevo, which means worship, is very present. Even the Greek word proskuneo means veneration. The
what
Greek word dulio
is worship.
We are meant to give dulio to Christians in love. Prove to
We're
me it's
not
worship,
meant
Dustin.
To bow before any graven image or any dead saint bones,
any bowing,
like the Muslims do.
All bowing
or anything else.
Goes to the person, to the saint, Dustin, as veneration. Learn the difference.
Okay. Doctrines of devils. Let's move back into the section.
Good luck with that.
So we're going to go right into, how much time do I have left?
28 minutes. 27. Oh, okay. 25. Okay.
Okay. So we're going to go through the historical context and some of these doctrines that are clearly anti-biblical. And you can tell me if the Greek somehow undoes God's word. Did God really say what he said?
Oh, no. The Greek is Mithraism. God chose that word. Chose Greek for his word.
It is commonly held belief among modern day churches that the predominance of Christianity resulted in Mithraic worship dying out in the 4th century. Such is not the case. Mithraism did not die out. Rather, Emperor Constantine the Great incorporated Mithraic beliefs and doctrines into the church during the 4th century, combining the two religions under one banner of Christianity, so-called. Following 300 years of persecutions, there weren't many early Christian believers left to protest and resist the intrusion and takeover of Mithraism into the church. They had all died, refusing to accommodate it. Constantine the Great.
Are you going
to
let me answer this?
Not until I'm done. So okay. Constantine the Great was an avid Mithras worshiper, and his devoted mother, Helena,
sounds good to me.
A great worshiper of Ishtar, my lady, the queen of heaven, as well as transferring most of the doctrines and tenets of Mithraism, he also turned the shrines and temples of Mithras and Helena into Christian churches after his claimed conversion to Christianity in 312 AD. He didn't abandon his occult practices after his conversion, but brought them into the church. He did this because Christianity and Mithraism were now so similar in their doctrines and tenets, it seemed logical to create one state religion out of the two who could.
You're going to have to ask me a question.
Universally, without question.
It's not time to pontificate. You have to ask me a question.
Well, I'm saying that Catholics worship Mithras. So it uses Christian names, and I can give you examples like the altars that you use are the exact same.
Can you do me a favor? Can you go back up to where you began there so I can begin rebutting? Can you do that?
No, because we're not done.
Okay.
Are you interrupting my time?
Well, I'm going to rebut it all. Take your time.
Okay. In his Edict of Milan, issue 313 AD.
You broke up. Can
a year after his supposed conversion, tolerance and quality were proclaimed to other cults and religions within the state. However, anyone who persisted in observing any other day than their venerable day of the sun, the state promoted day, were actively persecuted. So they outlawed Sabbath day in 313 AD, which was part of the Christian religion. At this time, the 7 Mithraic sacraments were adopted and retained in Catholicism to this day, and Christmas and Easter Mithraic holidays were also brought in. So rebut that.
I'm going to rebut it all. Okay, all of it. So thank you for that. You gave me great, great material. So and you can leave that up there if you want. I wrote it down. You don't have to. So you made the claim that Constantine basically syncretized Mithraism with the Christianity of the day. Unfortunately, when we look at the book of Revelation, as we looked at the Greek, very clearly that can't be the Catholic Church, because St. John of Patmos was looking at that particular harlot, saying it was present right there, eliminating the possibility that it could have been the Catholic Church being spoken of. By the way, that was never rebutted. Let me finish. I got to have to answer you. You spoke for a long time. You got to give me time to rebut you. I gave you time.
It's the same argument you gave earlier. It was never rebutted.
You never rebutted it, exactly. So you say Mithraism. You say, sure it was. You say Mithraism was syncretized, yet all you do is say it over and over without actually quoting a document. Notice what I said in my opening statement, Dustin, that I wanted one historical document to be quoted. You provide none. You don't provide any source material. Never do you provide it. You claim that the idea of the Queen of Heaven was condemned. You're right, it was condemned. You have it in the book of Jeremiah, a pagan figure condemned all the time. You even have sons of gods condemned. You have all kinds of paganism condemned. That doesn't mean that the Queen of Heaven of Revelation 12, because Mary's presented as the Queen of Heaven in Revelation 12, it doesn't mean that the Queen of Heaven of Revelation 12, which is Mary, is also condemnatory. We can talk about that in a bit. As far as things being outlawed, nothing was outlawed. The seven sacraments are biblical. Christmas being pagan is hilarious. Hilarious. Yes. There's no evidence of that. The earliest evidence, if we look in the early fathers, we look at St. Clement of Alexandria and many others from the earliest of eras, they were already celebrating the birthday of Christ. The idea that Sol Invictus, the idea that that became pagan, it was pagan, then it became Christian, that idea comes from the 19th century. That's bunk. That's garbage. That has no place in early history. So you got one person, you got you, who's relying on just mere words without any source material, and you got me, who's actually quoting material, Dustin.
Well, you can't deny the facts, and the facts are that
where are they?
The religion of Mithras, and anyone can test this. This is one of many points I'm going to make. But the religion of Mithras was basically changed to have Christian names. As I said, altar earlier. The altar is one example. The symbolism is another example. The history is there is a lot of history in support of it, but also there's Roman propaganda. They've had a lot, of time and money to put that out there. But look, let's look at the Jerome and
I'm going to answer that.
And the Greek
I'm going to answer that. You made the claim of Mithraism. I'm going to answer that.
Mithraism is Roman Catholicism.
Sure. So you made the claim of Mithraism because of the altar and what have you. Well, here's your big problem. In 1 Corinthians 10 and 1 Corinthians 11, we have the Greek word for altar, thusiasterion, used over and over for the Eucharist, presented as a sacrifice over and over. That altar, by the way, the evidence of Mithraism and all of this so-called ripping off comes way late in history. Go look at Justin the Martyr.
It's a carbon copy of a witch's altar.
I'm not done. Justin the Martyr will tell you that the pagans have aped the Christians. They have ripped them off. And we know that he's saying the truth because that altar, which you claim is pagan, you find it in the Bible. And you have it in Ignatius of Antioch as well. Look up that Greek word, thusiasterion, and the way it's used in the Bible, 1 Corinthians 10, 11. No. And in the book of Hebrews, then rebut me, my friend.
The Bible has specific commandments on how to create an altar, and that's not it. And it also doesn't engage in the sort of pagan and Wiccan sort of symbolism
ritual
is in the Catholic altar ritual.
Well, Dustin, during your cross-examination,
which is not
time. It's not time to pontificate, though.
So
I never made a bunch of statements, so I'm going to respond to that as well. You're claiming that all of this is pagan. Yes. All of this is pagan, yet I just showed you that the very word, that word was in the Bible. And the idea of the mass is a sacrifice. A thusiasterion is an altar where sacrifice is presented. The Greek word anamnesis is used for the Eucharist. It is a sacrifice presented, a sacrifice for all ages. So yes, the Bible does teach transubstantiation.
And the Mithraic ritual is so closely resembling
the sacrifice,
my turn, of the mass that Christian fathers charge the devil with inventing these similarities to mislead frail minds. Christianity was the last great creation of the ancient pagan world, according to those who buy into this, because they just believe Christianity was a copy of all the pagan things that came before it. That's why people today don't even believe Jesus was real, because of all of Rome's Catholic pagan insertions into Christianity, which essentially just sort of merged paganism to Jesus, and it doesn't make any sense. That's why documentaries like The Zeitgeist make the claim that Jesus was just a copy of all these other figures, which is not true at all. Another doctrine that the Catholic Church teaches is that God's law is done away with. Let's go into that. That is
I'm going to answer your claim on Mithraism. Please. And transubstantiation. If you want, my friend, if you want to start gathering all these things for me to answer and take your time away,
right here,
by all means.
Address why Catholics teach that God's law was done away with when Jesus died, saying not one iota would pass until heaven and earth pass.
Okay, let me deal first with Mithraism. So you claim that Mithraism, that basically what the Eucharist is ripping off of Mithraism. Not at all. You don't find within Mithraism the teaching of transubstantiation. It's not present there. All of the teachings of Mithraism, by the way, none of these so-called rising and dying pagan deities, none of them line up with Christianity. Not one of them. So notice yet again how over and over I have asked for source material. Rather, we're given Dustin's website. We're not given any source material. I challenge him to find one source, because if you go to St. Justin the Martyr, if you actually go to him, you're going to find Justin telling you they rip us off. They're copying all of this. And if you look at the manuscript history, the history of the documents, none of these rising and dying pagan deities, none of them line up. And by the way, if any of them were to line up, you'd expect to have a perpetual virgin mother.
I didn't make that point that they lined up. I said that they didn't.
So wait, but I made a Catholic point. If any of them lined up, you'd have to have a perpetually virgin mother, virgin births. None of them line up.
None of them line up. Isis. I agree.
Isis was not a virgin either. So none of them line up. As none far as God's law, very clearly, we agree. We believe that the moral law continues. We believe that.
The law continues.
We believe that the Never moral ended. Law continues. We don't
and
believe.
Catholics teach that it was done away with.
No. We are under God's law. We believe the moral law continues. So we hold to the Ten Commandments our Lord tells us to.
That's we believe not all
the Hold on, I'm not done. We hold, by the way, I don't know how this has to do with the debate, but I'm enjoying it. I can answer all
false
these.
Doctrines that Catholics teach. This is one of the biggest.
Actually, we're talking about her being the whore Babylon, but that's perfectly fine. We can deal with all these. So
this is part of it, is they teach false doctrine. That's why she's part of the whore.
Dustin, let me
The whore teaches
continue.
False doctrine and is filled with false teachers.
Dustin, let me continue, my friend. I'm gonna refute you here as well. So we don't believe that the whole of the law doesn't get followed. We believe that you've got to follow the commandments of God. We believe that. But we don't call us being under the old law. Rather, we are under the law of Christ, as Romans 3
tells
us.
Where does it say that you're not under the old law?
We're under the law of Christ, Romans chapter 3. It is called the law of Christ. The old law, we're no longer under that old law. We're now under the law of Christ. You want to read Romans 3? Open up Romans 3. We'll go through it.
Okay, so Paul himself taught that if we sin willfully after we have received knowledge
Dustin,
of the truth,
open
that there
up
no longer
Romans
remains
3.
A sacrifice for sins.
Open up Romans 3 if you want me to smoke this. Open up Romans 3.
I will open up Romans. However, you can't show that the law was done away with.
I just answered you, Dustin. And you asked me to show where we're under the law of Christ. Open
and
up
I
Romans
just rebutted
3.
You when Paul himself said that the law is not done away with.
I never said the whole of the law was done away with, Dustin.
But you do say
agreed.
That the old law was done away with.
No, I said we're under the law of Christ. It is called the law of Christ now.
The
it's
law
not
of Christ
called
is
the old,
the
law.
Old Testament law.
No, it is not, because we are not under works of
yes,
the law anymore.
We are
no,
under
we are not.
The Old Testament law.
Okay, I'm going to read it to you. I'm going to rebut you. If you don't want to open it up, I'm going to open it up. If you don't want to open it up, let me open it up.
1 John 3, whosoever committeth sin transgresseth.
I'm opening it up.
Also
so
the
let's
law,
look.
For sin is the transgression of the law.
So
when you
I am
sin,
going,
it's because you're violating God's laws.
So I am going to answer it for you, since you don't want to open it up. Romans 3:27. What becomes of boasting? It is excluded. Through what kind of law? That of works? No, we're not under the law of works anymore. No, rather through the law of faith. For we hold that a person is justified by faith apart from the works of the law. We are not under the law, the works of the law.
No.
Those obligatory works. Rebut that one, my friend.
James 2:14-26. Even so, faith, if it hath not works, is dead, being alone.
Those are not works of the law, my friend. Those are
yes,
works under... No, they are not.
James 2:14-26 rebuts you.
No, that says that we are justified by works, not faith alone. Not works of the law. Show me where it says works of the law.
We're not justified by works alone or faith alone. We're justified by
I agree, Dustin.
Both.
We agree. Dustin, we agree
so why
there.
Why do you believe that the Old Testament law was done away with? Makes no sense.
Dustin, let me correct you, because we're talking past each other. So in James chapter 2, and don't interrupt me. I'm not going to go long, I promise. James chapter 2, we are on the same page. We agree. And by the way, I'm shocked that you don't believe in faith alone, sola fide. But anyway, James 2, I agree with you.
No.
We're not saved
faith
by
faith. Faith without works is dead.
Wonderful. Great. We're on the same page. We agree there. We're not.
No.
Yes. Dustin, let me finish
works
speaking.
Works is following the Old Testament
Dustin,
law.
My friend, let me finish speaking. We agree. We are not saved by faith alone. James chapter 2 says we're justified by works, not faith alone. But your problem, Dustin, is that those are not works of the law. We're never told that works of the law are going to justify us. Romans 3:28 says we are not justified by works of the law. There's a big difference between
the work
good
is the
works.
Law.
No, it is not, my friend. We're told specifically in Romans 3, we are not justified by works of the law. Good luck with that.
Okay, so the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. Psalm 19:7. Whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law, for sin is the transgression of the law. Hebrews 10:26 says, for if we sin willfully after we have received the knowledge of the truth, which is a violation of the law, that's what sin is, then there no longer remains a sacrifice for sins. Jesus casts you out. He says, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name?
Dustin, we believe in all
this.
Then
I will declare to them, I never knew you, and depart from me, you practice lawlessness.
Yeah, we agree with all this.
Jesus died to bring us to the Old Testament law.
No, he did not. We are specifically told, Dustin, we're specifically told that we continue to follow the moral commandments, which are part of the moral law. We are told that, Dustin. But we are told
all of the law.
Dustin, I am not done. And if you keep interrupting me, I'm going to keep going longer. Let me finish, Dustin. I'm going to keep going longer if you don't let me.
The image speaks for itself. You talk longer, they see this longer.
Dustin, you can keep the image up all you want. I got a beautiful one in my closing, and you've been smoked the whole evening, my friend. Oh, afternoon.
You say that, but like, I don't believe the audience in the comments.
Yeah, well, I want to see what the comments show afterwards. So let me answer that. I said it again, and I'm going to double down again. We agree with everything that the Bible says. James 2, saved by works, not faith alone, meaning both of them. But what kind of works are being talked about? Are we under the old law? No, we're under the law of faith. Romans 3:28, we're not saved by works of the law. Those are condemnatory. No. We're no longer under them, Dustin.
1 John 2 and 1 John 5 says, for this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. And also, by this, we know that we have come to know him if we keep his commandments, not the moral commandments, but his commandments.
No,
the one who says, I have come to know him and does not keep his commandments is a liar. All of the law is the moral law.
Dustin,
all of it.
Those are not considered works of the law, Dustin. Do you know what the works of the law are?
The law is the law.
Dustin,
and if you
you are wrong.
Old Testament law, you're rejected, Dustin, by Jesus.
No, Dustin, look up any scholarly resource. The works of the law.
Sola Scriptura.
And I'm talking about the Bible. The works of the law, we don't consider keeping the commandments and loving your neighbor and loving one another to be part of the works of the law, Dustin. We don't consider that, which is why Romans 3:28 condemns it.
You teach that the Old Testament law was done away with, right?
I teach that the Old Testament works of the law are abrogated. As Romans 3:28 says.
Abrogated. What does abrogated mean?
That means that we're not under the works of the law. Very simple, Dustin.
Okay, but what does it say in Matthew 7:22-23 here? Can you read that?
Let me read it. Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name? Then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. Do you know what lawlessness means?
Yeah, please tell me that last word there. Lawlessness means, as far as I know, those who don't follow the law.
Absolutely
violations of
not.
The law.
Absolutely.
And in fact,
not. Means,
we're actually given a
those...
definition in 1 John 3. Whosoever committeth,
no,
you ask me
wrong.
A question. So who 1 John 3 answers that question. Whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law.
Yeah,
sin
so
is transgression of the law.
Here's an important thing. Here's an important thing. The way lawlessness is used over and over, it is lack of love, lack of charity, lack of keratos.
No, it's lack
over
of
and
law.
Over.
Lack
no, it
of
is
law.
Not. Dustin, lawlessness means, that you are not following the law of God, which is the love
of
God. Not the Old Testament, Dustin.
The law of God is written
Dustin,
in the Bible.
What you need to do, you need to prove to us that the works of the law are still in effect. When I've shown you in Romans 3:28, the Bible says they are not in effect. We're under the law of faith, not the law, the works of the law. Then what does it say when it says that we're not justified by works of the law, Dustin? What does that mean?
Because works of the law will not get you into heaven without faith. Clearly, you need both.
Jesus, but it tells you,
Peter, Jude, and John warn against this encroachment of antimonianism or lawlessness.
But Dustin, it tells you, you're not justified by works of the law. If it was works of the law and faith, he wouldn't use the words that he's using there. He's telling you works of the law do not provide righteousness, justice. You don't
know, but you
justified.
Still are required to follow them because of love of God. If you don't follow
God's
rules,
he doesn't say
that,
Dustin.
He will reject you, just as he tells you.
No, Dustin. He tells you we're now under the law of faith.
And Jesus warned us.
No, Dustin.
Because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold.
I think your problem, Dustin, is that you think you're a Bible scholar. You can't deal with any of the Greek.
I can't answer any of this. We're in a big circle. Dustin, you can't answer it.
I've answered the whole thing. Dustin,
no,
you're
it. Whosoever you're, committeth your sin transgresseth what?
Your little image here isn't going to save
sin?
You.
Dustin, John, what is sin according to 1 John 3?
So I'm going to answer you. Your little please. Image here. Your
it's
little image
line.
Here.
Just read it, please.
Are you done
interrupting
me?
I didn't ask you a question about my image. I asked you about what 1 John 3 says.
When you're done interrupting me, I'm going to answer.
Please answer. 1 John 3, what does it say?
It tells you there. Where is 1 John 3? Whoever commits a sin transgresses also the law, for sin is a transgression of the law. We agree. We are under, don't interrupt me, we've got to follow the moral commandments, Dustin, as our Lord said, now I'm not done. I'm not done answering. Which our Lord tells us, you've got to love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your might and love your neighbor. Those are the sum of the law, we are told over and over.
And
I'm not
God
done,
also
Dustin.
Defines love by following his laws in law 1 John 2.
Yes, the law of faith,
right
Dustin.
Here. No, the Dustin. Laws of the Bible, not the law of the faith, the laws of the Bible, including the dietary laws, the feast days, and the moral laws.
No, sir, you are incorrect. Because those are works of the law. Then
that's
show
exactly
me.
What it says, that you will be rejected if you reject.
You are incorrect.
We're going to go in the circle right here. As you said, 1 John 3, defines sin as violation of the law. Now, what does Psalm 19:7 say about the law?
So I'm going to answer that for you, Dustin. You claim that we are still under the works
of
the law.
Now, what does it say?
I'm not done, Dustin.
That's what I've asked you, is what does Psalm 19:7 say? That is my question.
Still under
you're answering
the
stuff I didn't ask.
Yeah, you did. You claim,
now, Maud,
you've been saying,
can we get some...
You've been saying
moderation
this whole time
here.
That we're under the works of the law. Romans 3:28 says...
And we are, and we're going through it logically.
So tell me right now, why does Romans 3:28 say we're not justified by works of the law? Why does it say that?
Because people were trying to get into heaven by just following the law, and they had no faith, like the Pharisees, which is part of the whole context
it doesn't
of
say that,
why
Dustin.
Jesus came to save us from the traditions of the elders,
Dustin,
the Talmud,
where
with
does
the
it
law,
say that?
Which he
where
said, not one iota Dustin? Would pass until heaven and earth pass.
Dustin, where does Romans 3:28
say
that?
Okay, so we're continuing.
Oh, no.
Right here. So
you're cross-examining me. You're cross-examining me.
It's perfect. So what does Psalm 19:7 say about the law?
So you're not going to provide an answer for me then. Romans 3:28, we're not
justified. I'm answering you right now, and
you're
going off somewhere else. I asked you about what Psalm 19:7 says.
Psalm 19 is under the old law.
We'll get to Romans 2.
Yeah, Psalm 19 is under the old law. It's the Old Testament, brother. Psalm 19.
There's no such thing as Old Testament. That Bible book, that page can be ripped out because Bibles did not include that.
Dustin,
before Jesus didn't say New Testament or Old
Testament.
Once
our Lord comes,
the Bible writers did not put in those pages.
Once our Lord comes, we read in the Bible that the commandments is hammered to the cross, is what we read.
No.
So there is a massive change, Dustin. And then we read in Romans 3:28 that we're no longer under that old law. We're under the law of faith, Dustin, not under that old law. So there is a change. The onus is on you to show me justified. The Bible says we're not justified. Notice
Jesus
not.
Himself, the highest authority in the Bible,
God's law
God said
eternal.
Not one iota would pass. One iota. What does one iota mean?
God's law.
That's
God's
a Greek
law.
Word, right? Iota?
Dustin, God's law is eternal.
I'm
God's
asking
law
a question,
eternal.
Specific question. Can you
Dustin,
answer or not?
You're gonna have to let me answer, or I'm gonna take up the rest of your time. You got 5 minutes left.
You're not gonna take over my time, buddy.
Oh,
I can.
Oh, I guarantee you, I will. You don't let me answer.
1 John 3 says the law is the violation of the law is sin. The
so
perfect
Dustin,
law, according to Psalm 19:7, which in Hebrews Paul says you will be rejected if you reject. Also, Jesus
Dustin,
backs this up in Matthew, saying, "I will reject you if you reject lawless. If you're lawless."
So the lawlessness
keep going.
Is not talking
I mean, you
about
keep saying that you claim to love
Dustin.
God. You're a liar. You love your neighbor, but that is defined by following the law. Because
Dustin.
In 1 John 2, it says right here.
Elliott,
answer,
I'm going to have to be able to answer.
By this, we know that we have come to keep
I'm going to have
him.
To be able to answer.
You're trying to dominate
rambling.
And monopolize my time.
This
1 John
rambling.
2 says you don't
I'm going to have to be able to answer.
You don't love God unless
I'm going to have to be able to answer at one point, Dustin.
William, hang on.
Now you're up.
Let him finish what he's saying.
1 John 2, answer. And but 1 John 5.
I'm going to have to be able to answer, though, Elliott. He's gone on a crazy rant. At one point, I have to
a
be able to answer.
You can't avoid.
I've told you over and over.
Doom loop of logic.
Elliott, I mean, how am I going to answer if he's talking endlessly?
Answer.
Dustin, what is the question? If you
What's the question? Yeah, let me answer.
The question is, why do you believe that the Old Testament, and teach as a Catholic church, which is a false doctrine to lead people to damnation as the Scarlet Whore of Babylon does? Why
ask your question, Dustin.
Jesus's law was done away with when Jesus himself said, not one iota would pass until heaven and earth pass away. It is eternal. He came fighting against the Pharisees who were teaching the tradition of the elders against the law. He wanted to replace the tradition of the elders, the commandments of man, the Catholic teachings, with the law.
Yeah, so let me read, quote the passage for me. What passage were you referring to? Quote it for me.
1 John Matthew, 2 and 1 John 5,
okay, for example. Here it is. Matthew 5.
It's all here.
Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Yep. The Greek word there is plerao, to make full. All was accomplished already. He died on the cross. It tells you right there. Do not think I've come to abolish it until it's fulfilled, he tells you. There's a very big change that occurs there.
Context.
You've got the Greek word, yes, Matthew 5:17, context. I have not come to abolish, but to fulfill. The fulfilling changes it. The Greek word plerao there, Dustin. Then show me that I'm wrong. So
the
here's
law is eternal. Jesus himself said,
he
not
tells
one
right
iota
there.
Would pass until heaven and earth pass away. What does that mean?
And I just rebutted you. He tells you right there. I've come.
You're saying he fulfilled it then, but he's saying until heaven and earth pass
away,
can never be fulfilled.
Yes.
And we're still
here. He's telling you the moral law remains. Listen.
No, we're still here on earth. Heaven and earth haven't passed away.
I'm not done.
The law is still there.
Dustin, I'm not
done. You're ignoring this.
He tells you right there in Matthew 5:17, do not think I have come to abolish the law of the prophets. Mm-hmm. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. That changes.
No,
we also realize in Romans 6, for sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under the law, but under grace. We're not under the law anymore. Romans 3:28 tells you, what kind of law are we under? The law of faith. That's why we read in Romans 3:28, we're not justified by works. There's a change there.
No,
even in our Lord's words, buddy, the Greek word plerao. Even in
you're ignoring
words,
one iota would not pass away until which passed away after that?
We're still under the moral law.
Heaven and earth passed away? Are
they
passed away
yet? We're still under the moral law, brother.
Would you like to argue that heaven and earth passed away?
We're still under the moral law, and we will
which is
be
the
forever.
Law. The moral law
no,
is the law. And
those
also
are the commandments.
The
no,
dietary
sir.
Laws and the feast
nope.
days. Yeah.
If you were correct about that, Dustin.
All the law, man. You're cutting the law of pieces, which is not allowed.
If I'm doing what the Lord said.
No, you're not.
If you
fulfill
were correct,
does not change the law.
Plerao. It means
fulfill
there's a change,
change
there.
The law.
Yes, it does.
Even if
we are
you
no
were to
longer
get a ticket and go fulfill your ticket,
no,
you're
sir.
Still going to have to follow that law the next
no,
day.
No, sir. We are no longer
ticket.
We are no longer under the old law.
No,
we're
so
under the
says.
Law of faith. And that law of faith retains
that's
the commandments, the moral law. That is why being under the new law, the law of faith, we're not justified by works of the law, Dustin. I mean, you've run around in circles. You think this little image is going to save you?
Full well,
you've
you
run
reject
around.
The commandment of God that you may keep your own tradition.
No, I do not. You're incorrect. Yes. We hold, as 2 Thessalonians says, Dustin, to tradition and the written word. But,
no.
Dustin, you're incorrect
Scriptura.
Here. You're incorrect. Well, I just read 2 Thessalonians to you, Dustin. That's
and
a
I just read
book.
You all these verses which tell you if you don't follow the law, you go to hell.
And I've rebutted all of them.
No, you
told
haven't.
You,
you're going in a circle.
None of them mean
you're
that
going
we're
in a
under
circle, and your
the
argument
old
is,
law.
Your argument is fulfillment
Dustin,
means the law was done away with.
Dustin, you got
one iota.
Dustin, brother, you got smoked, my friend. You got smoked, brother.
Which arguments?
Every single
Let's
one.
Let's see it in the comments.
Brother.
Which arguments did he win?
Every single one. We will see. We'll see.
Yeah?
We'll see. And I
we
think
we'll see.
About All 10 right. seconds. Ask me one more question. Ask me one more.
Okay, so why do you believe that the law was done away with when God says, Jesus says, not
okay.
one iota would pass away until heaven and earth pass away?
I'm going to answer that very clearly. There is a change in what kind of law we are under. We are under
okay.
the law of faith, but we are not to hold to the works of the law, as Romans 3:28 tells you. We're told in the book of Romans, we're not under the law anymore. But the moral law, holding to the commandments, will never go away, Dustin. Very simple answer.
Where does it say that?
Just told you, Matthew 5:17. I read it for you. And when our Lord tells you.
The law will never go away. It doesn't say the moral law. It says
No. It says there'll be a fulfillment. There'll be a change. It says that there'll be a fulfillment. And Romans 6 says, sin has no dominion over you. You're not under the law. But under grace.
What I'm hearing you say is that
Galatians
2.
Okay. Hey, guys.
I think that's it.
What about one iota?
So
I think that's it.
We're at 45 minutes. And so closing statements.
Yeah, yeah. Sorry, went over. Sorry about that. I get my closing. Let me get me a little bit of a drink. One moment, okay. Man, I'm losing my voice here, man. Okay. Let me put the slide up. Okay. Then let me share. And I will begin. Oops. Now. Okay. So let me finish off by showing you what we mean when we call Mary the holy, sinless Queen of Heaven. Then the temple of God was open in heaven, and the ark of his covenant was seen in his temple. And there were lightnings, noises, thunderings, an earthquake, and great hail. Revelation 12. Now a great sign appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, and the moon under her feet, and on her head a crown of 12 stars. The woman presented to us here in the book of Revelation is Mary. The earliest interpretations from the second century on interpret Mary as the woman of heaven, bodily assumed to heaven, crowned in heaven, and as the queen of heaven. Over and over, nothing was dealt with in today's debate. We read about the whore of Babylon. We looked at the present tense of the Greek. We tried to look at source material. Dustin had none. He had nothing to deal with, absolutely nothing. He mentioned tons of councils. It was wrong on all of them. Mentioned Nicaea was wrong. Ephesus was wrong. He conceded most of the opening of the debate. He gave me the title Theotokos. He gave me that, which is good. It was part of the debate, but he gave us that, so we'll give him that. He couldn't deal with Luke 1, couldn't deal with Ephesians 1, couldn't deal with the whore of Babylon. Asked him to name one early church father that viewed the church as a whore, couldn't name one. Asked him to provide source material of Constantine, couldn't name one. Said, well, you know, go over the material, check it over. He claimed that we're still under the law, yet he ignored every single thing that I brought up. Over and over, I was quoting from the Bible. I said, well, look, there's a circle you're going in. What does our Lord talk about? Well, our Lord literally tells you, pleroo, fulfillment. Literally tells you to hold to the commandments of love your neighbor, love your Lord. Over and over, we're told. We are told what the moral law of the Lord is. We're told we're under the law of faith. And then in Romans 3, we clearly read that we're not under the works of the law. But he wants you to believe that we're still under them, even though Paul tells you we're not justified by the works of the law. He tells you that they're part of James 2. Here's the problem. Nobody ever in church history ever interpreted it that way. Not a one person other than Dustin Nemos in 2023. Nobody else in all of history. Says, well, the law is never going to go away. It's eternal. We agree. We're talking about the moral law. We're not talking about the works where you work and you are obligating the Lord. There's a huge difference there. We're not talking about that kind of a work or those kinds of works. We read Romans to him. He couldn't deal with it. What you have here is a gentleman who claimed to have been a Bible scholar, who couldn't deal with a lick of Greek, doesn't know a lick of Greek, doesn't know how to use concordances, but was wrong on every single council, all of them. And look, maybe it would be, you know, it's passable if you get one wrong. But the fact that he got them all wrong, every one of them. Nicaea talks about the canon, where? Ephesus talks about the canon, where? He agreed with the title Theotokos. So, hey, hats off to him there. Although he had to agree with it because he was smoked. He was smoked in Luke 1 and 2 Samuel. How would he disagree? He made egregious claims in St. Cyril. Never even researched it for himself. Miriam, you know, look at that book. Go quote that book. We don't want to look at what book has to say. We want firsthand source material. That is what we want. Couldn't even give you one. Couldn't give you one early church father. We brought up Origen, a great ecclesiastical writer. We brought up Hippolytus. We brought up St. Irenaeus. We brought up the Subtuum Presidium. Couldn't deal with any of them. Oh, sola scriptura. Yet he doesn't even know how he got his own canon. Says, well, you guys, you know, remove books from the Bible when? And even Google wasn't able to save him there. He tried looking up on Google. But there was nothing there. Claimed, oh, well, Mary was made sinless in 1864. We had to help him there. But it wasn't even there. He's talking about the papal bull in Ineffabilis Deus. But You look in 451, she was already declared to have no guilt. And it was taught way before that. I asked him to deal with Luke 1, Ephesians 1. Oh, well, you know, I don't agree with your reading of it. Then refute it, rebut it. He said that the Greek of Revelation 17 was futuristic. I mean, the guy's a regular day biblical scholar, and the Greek of Revelation is futuristic? Really? No, it's not. It's a vision in front of him. Yet he tells you Constantine founded the Catholic Church, but the vision of the whore is present tense right there in front of you. Right there in front of you. Furthermore, what the Bible says about Mary is incredible. She's presented as the all-holy, stainless, sinless. She is full of a particular kind of grace, a particular sinless kind of grace, kecharitomene, that you find in the book of Ephesians 1. She's full of that kind of grace. No rebuttal there. Nothing. He had no rebuttal. Oh, well, the church is full of demons. Hey, good for you, man. You think that? Good for you. Rebut me. Oh, well, the church is full of demons. They're liars. Well, rebut it. You know, rebut something. He said that Constantine did this, did that. I mean, for goodness sake, we have the language of Constantine preserved. Go look at Eusebius of Caesarea. Where are any of these claims anywhere in church history? You've got to be able to come to a debate with scholarly resource material and quote firsthand resource material, not merely say, well, this is the case. Well, where's the evidence? Where do we have the evidence? It's not there. Council after council said, well, do you believe Mary raised the dead? Do you believe Mary rose from the dead? He doesn't even know what we believe. He does not even know what we believe. Said, well, those saints, you know, they're dead. Not according to the Bible. The Bible says they're za'o, they're living. No objection to that. There was zero objections to any of the biblical Greek put forth. There were zero objections to any of the church fathers. Zero to any of the councils. There's nothing other than Dustin disagreeing with Paul. Dustin's like, well, you know, who cares what Paul says? We're not justified by the works of the law. Who cares what Paul says? Dustin will have learned his lesson after today to not claim to line him up and knock him down, because he doesn't know how to quote firsthand source material. And I hope he does correct those errors in his webpage. But with that, Dustin, my friend, I had a great time. I hope to do it again in the future. Use my final 5 seconds to say it was lively, brother, but I consider you a friend, and I look forward to hearing how you have to close.
Okay.
Hold on. Let me stop sharing. Let me stop. There we go.
He argues against dates rather than doctrines, but this is a moot issue. If it happened, then my point stands, regardless of if I'm off a year or two. He claims I don't use sources, but then ignores my sources because they aren't biblical, but then ignores the biblical verses that I use using his non-biblical sources. So I stick to sola scriptura. If you trust Catholic doctrine and history, then the entire Bible is undone. In Proverbs 4:2, it says, "For I gave you good doctrine. Forsake ye not my Torah." Paul kept the law and taught the law. Jesus also, and all the other apostles, kept the law and taught the law. Even though the law was supposedly done away with, they still kept it after he died, and they still taught it after he died. Even in Romans 6:15, it says, "What then? Shall we sin because we are not under law, but under grace? Certainly not." And in John 1 John 3-4, it says, "Whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also against the law, also the law, for sin is the transgression of the law." God defines sin, evil, as the violation of his laws. It doesn't say moral laws. It says laws listed in the Bible, primarily around like Leviticus and such, the law books, which are filled with other non-moral laws about how to treat your neighbor. Also, well, not about how to treat your neighbor, how to proper hygiene, for example, not necessarily a moral law. Certain other types of laws like the feast days, for example. So, continuing on, many well-meaning Christians twist and distort Paul's writings to advocate for a Nicolaitan doctrine of grace at the expense of the law. But in Revelations 2:5-7, "Therefore, keep in mind how far you have fallen. Repent and perform the deeds you did at first. But if you do not repent, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place. But you have this to your credit. You hate the works of the Nicolaitans." Again, as I said earlier, the Nicolaitans were teaching against the law. "So, which I also hate. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who overcomes, I will grant the right to eat from the tree of life in the paradise of God." And also in Hosea 4:6, it says, "My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because you have rejected knowledge, I also will reject you from being my priest. Since you have forgotten the law of your God, I also will forget your children. I ask you today, if people in the audience, if you believe that God remembers your children without following his law in the state of the world that we're in today. Also, Matthew 7, 15 to 20, it says, wherefore by their fruits ye shall know them. I can easily say, test the fruits of Rome, and by their fruits you will know them. Also, we had 100% check for all the signs for the Whore of Babylon. Check, 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 all of them. We are going on all cylinders. So please keep that in mind. Prophecy is 100% accurate across hundreds or even thousands of years with fine detail. This is part of why I became a Christian rather than a Buddhist. When I understood the shape of the earth and there is a God, then I certainly had to accept which God it was, the only Bible in the world that has all of these prophecies by the hundreds, even the thousands, being completed in fine detail. And that's pretty much it. I guess I could go back and sort of recap my introduction. How long do I have left?
4.5 minutes.
Ah, perfect. Okay, so going right back into the introduction, I'll share the screen again. Boom, who controls the world? Them. Nope. Okay. Scarlet Whore of Babylon. Introductions. Rome. I am not merely saying Catholicism gets it wrong, got it wrong sometime back then, or has gone astray. Nor am I really hoping to debate the nuance of Roman propaganda and history as a pseudo-Christian entity. I am directly cutting through the nonsense, the bullshit, and saying that since before its inception, it was a lifelong pagan and false convert, Roman Emperor Constantine's way to stop Christianity by paganizing it and monopolizing it. It was a perversion by Satan. Its very claims to authority, apostolic, are a lie. Peter never even went to Rome, much less was the first pope. It was all a fabricated pretextual authority for Rome's bishops. Hundreds of years after Christ, a deception by the Scarlet Whore of Babylon, and it's the inventor and pioneer of modern fake news and fake science. Cardinal Wolsey, learning against learning is why most of us today were taught since birth that the world is a globe. All of this is nonsense, and there is zero evidence for it. In fact, they can't give you a single image that isn't art or CGI or has sex written in the clouds. Look at all those different blue marbles. Obama's is my favorite, but they can't agree. Anyway, there is no redeeming quality. Fatima is a demon. Yahweh's actual messengers are angels, and that's what angel means, Malak. William can confirm this for me. He does not send dead spirits from Sheol to communicate messages to us. He forbids communicating with or praying to the dead under any circumstances. These false preachers teach people to pray to dead bones and angels alongside Muslims. Look it up. Same rituals, different words, same symbols, the crescent and the moon. Nothing about them is Christian beyond the naming scheme. Nothing. Their Jesus isn't even a real. It's a baby, and it's baby Tammuz, Semiramis, and Nimrod's child. Rome, and I have a great section on this that goes into the symbols and stuff for people to see the historical examples and the sources and the images. I just didn't have time today. Rome and its evil, necrotic, pagan mimicry of Christ's true faith, which has never stopped persecuting, is the cause and culprit of the great falling away and apostasy. Time check, Elliot.
2 minutes.
How long? I got? 2 minutes. Okay. There is no defense for her. There is no defending her. She is anathema to biblical doctrine. She is evil. Her history is evil, full of systemic Christian mass murder and child rape. 50 million believers in the Bible have been killed for reading the Bible, often with their Bibles tied around their neck as they were burnt at the stake alive. Her tenets and doctrine are wholly pagan, hated by Yahweh God. She truly sits upon seven hills with a golden cup filled with the filth of her fornications, as prophecy said she would. This is how the Roman Catholic Church was formed. It's a mixture of occultism, paganism, and a hint of Christianity. God hates mixtures. A little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. When you think of how the Catholic Church came together, 300 and 400 AD, think amalgamation. Some foolishly or groundlessly believe that the Roman Catholic Church started off correctly, biblically, but not so. They have no clue of history or how this Antichrist cult was formed. And I stand by everything I said today. Just check and test all things. We obviously didn't have time to go into the full article or all of the sources. It's about the length of a book, really. So it was just a little bit unfair to, I think, expect me to have everything memorized. And I admit I should, because this is a debate. However, I stand by this: test all things and hold fast that which is true. And I say that often in debates when I can't remember every single fact. But again, the doctrines of devils, the violence against real believers, the authority that's not there, and Rome's credibility is, again, broker than the Ten Commandments. So if you want to learn any of these things, such as the anti-Christian history or the doctrines of devils or any of these things, and I would love help to source and to cite everything perfectly, so I may have to go through and edit my articles. I do almost weekly, so it's getting better every day. It's getting more accurate. But even if you were to knock off 1 year that I was off by 5 or 6 years, my points stand. The arguments still stand. 100% check marks for the Scarlet Whore of Babylon. The Bible says not sinless unless you start to twist the words. And the Bible also says the law, not the moral law, but all of the law, unless you start to, again, twist the words, ignoring all of those circular logic passages that I showed. So again, I think I could have done better on this debate, but I don't think that I've lost it. I hope that people will test it and hold fast that which is true, as God says. Be good Bereans and seek out the truth. I think that's it. How was my time?
That's it. You're up.
Perfect. Okay.
Very good. Very good. Interesting debate.
That was a blast, guys.
I
appreciate you guys taking some time to do this.
I got no voice.
There's still a
guys.
Q&A?
No, I think we're
There's
good.
No
we're
Q&A,
gonna,
right?
No, we got to move to Zoom, so we're gonna it'll be aired later.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Very good. Well, thanks again, guys, and I hope you guys enjoy the rest of your day. And until next time,
y'all take care.
God bless.